Good morning. I'm State Representative Chris Ross, Chair of the Liquor Committee, and I would like to call to order this Liquor Control Committee informational meeting on the subject of wholesale distribution and the fees, charges that are associated with that, as well as the logistics involved in that. I want to thank everybody for joining us today. I also wanted to announce for all those in attendance, this meeting is being videotaped by the Broadcasting Office of the House Bipartisan Management Committee. The video is also being made available to the news media and for streaming on House websites. At this time, I would like to introduce my fellow chair, Representative Costa, for any comments that you'd like to make.
No comments, just thank everyone for being here and look forward to hearing testimony.
And now I'd like the members that are present to introduce themselves. If we could start with the table over at the far end there with Representative Regan and Payne.
Sure. Mike Regan, 92nd District from Cumberland and York County.
John Payne, 106th District, Southern Dauphin County.
Scott Petri, Bucks County, 178th District.
Kurt Sonney, Erie County, 4th District.
Peter Schweyer, 22nd District, Lehigh County.
Pat Harkins, 1st District, Erie.
Cheryl Delozier, 88th District, Cumberland County.
Mike Reese, 59th District, Westmoreland and Somerset Counties.
Thank you. And I'm expecting some other members will be joining us as we go forward here. I called this meeting in particular because I think much of the knowledge that people have, the average citizen and even some of the members, we have greater familiarity with liquor sales as we see them in the retail stores or in restaurants. But I felt that there was a lack of knowledge about how the product, the wine and spirits, gets from the distillery or winery to the retail outlets. What happens at each stage? Who's responsible for what? How prices are built up over time? And so I'm hoping that the meeting today will wind up giving more information both to the members and to the public about this system so that we can better understand how to consider improvements or changes to it. So that being said, I want to move right ahead. I want to thank all the folks who have joined us here today. And our opening panel is the Liquor Control Board, Chairman Tim Holden, members Joseph Skip Bryan, Michael Negra, and the Executive Director, John Metzger. So, gentlemen, would you please begin?
Thank you. Good morning. On behalf of my fellow board members, Skip Bryan and Mike Negra, and our Executive Director, John Metzger, I would like to thank Chairman Ross and Chairman Costa and all the members of the House Liquor Control Committee for inviting the Pennsylvania Liquor Control Board here to address the logistics and distribution of wine and spirits in Pennsylvania, as well as the markup structure that is applied to the products we sell. Before we begin our presentation of the PLCB's operation, I would like to provide you with some context for today's discussion. I ask you to please direct your attention to the map on the screen. Following the repeal of prohibition, states were given the authority to regulate the sale of beverage alcohol as they deemed appropriate. Pennsylvania chose to become a control state, which means that it directly controlled the distribution and or sale of beverage alcohol within its borders. We were not alone then, and we are not alone now. In fact, 17 states and several jurisdictions currently operate forms of a control model. As you can see, these control jurisdictions spread throughout the country. Control systems are not unique to the United States either. Many other countries have adopted similar alcohol beverage control systems. In Canada, for example, every province is a control jurisdiction with the exception of Alberta, which privatized its retail operations. All other Canadian provinces maintain government ownership and control, particularly over distilled spirits. While each control state identified in the map is unique in its level of control, the common characteristic they share is that they take ownership of liquor products at some point in the three-tier system of alcohol distribution and sales. The three-tier system, simply put, is a system in which liquor manufacturers sell products to wholesalers who in turn sell products to retailers. As I mentioned, each control state jurisdiction is unique in its level of control. The chart you see illustrates what product states control at the wholesale and retail levels. Pennsylvania is not unique in its wholesale and retail control of liquor products. Control states sell different types of alcohol products, distilled spirits, fortified wine, and/or table wine at wholesale, and a significant number, including the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, also sell variations of alcohol products at retail. In fact, each of the 50 states, the District of Columbia, the United States territories, has an alcohol beverage control agency or bureau that regulates the distribution and sale of alcohol. All states enforce rules for selling alcohol products within their jurisdictions. Further, all states operate under the constraints laid out by federal laws and federal regulations. In closing, I want to provide you with a brief update on the PLCB sales of wine and spirits for fiscal year 2014-2015, which you know ended on June 30th. While we have not released our final sales results as they are currently being finalized, we are happy to report that our preliminary review indicates that sales grew at a robust 4.2% over the prior fiscal year. That is a 38% improvement from the prior year's performance, resulting in a 4.6% increase in gross income from sales. I am also pleased to report that for July, the first month of this new fiscal year, our sales have increased 7%, a terrific start for this new fiscal year. As you know, the PLCB transferred $80 million to the general fund in fiscal year 2014-2015 and nearly $26 million to the Pennsylvania State Police Bureau of Liquor Control Enforcement for their enforcement efforts. Revenue remitted directly to the general fund from the 18% liquor tax and the 6% sales tax increased by more than 4.2% for a total of $465 million. With that said, I'm going to hand the presentation over to our Executive Director, John Metzger, and thank you for the opportunity to address you this morning.
Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to make this presentation to you, Chairman Ross and Chairman Costa, and the House Liquor Control Committee on behalf of myself, the board, and the executives at the PLCB. There's going to be four parts to my presentation today. The first one is how the PLCB operates. How does it move product through the system, the physical distribution of our products? The second item is a review of our bailment program. The third is a review of the pricing structure, and the fourth will be a discussion on the August 1st, 2015 change to the LTMF. Chairman Holden mentioned the three-tier system. I thought I would just show it real quick. First off, there's manufacturers, there's wholesalers, and there's retailers. This is a summary of that. In Pennsylvania, the PLCB serves as both the wholesaler and retailer, fulfilling those two tiers of the three-tier system. Other states, open or control, all have specific laws that govern activities and all operate under the federal law and direction of the TTB, the Alcohol, Tobacco, Tax, and Trade Bureau. Here's a map of Pennsylvania with all 604 stores indicated along with our three distribution centers in the state. Note the density of stores correlates to the population density of the state, and also note that we have at least one store in every county across Pennsylvania. Here's a couple key facts regarding the fiscal year we just finished. The total sales and tax revenue for the state totaled $2.335 billion. The net income, which is our pure profit, we're estimating to be $117 million. It's still not final. We're waiting for accruals and a few things to come in yet. The channels we're operating in is the direct retail stores, wholesale, e-commerce, and special liquor orders. Already mentioned 604 stores. We have approximately 5,000 employees, 18,000 licensees in the state. Now, we offer across those channels a little over 65,000 products to the citizens of Pennsylvania. Of that, the ones carried in the stores are the 3,286 listed products, 14,927 luxury and chairman selection products, and then a little over 40,000 special liquor order items. We have an e-commerce store I mentioned, and there we have 1,500 unique high-end products that are sold online to consumers. Our purchases of this product that contributes toward the sales and revenue number above is approximately $1.3 billion of wine and spirits today, and this changes almost daily because we have new wineries coming and going constantly. And we have 248 suppliers. I mentioned the three distribution centers totaling 903,000 square feet, $2.4 million capacity. Our case shipments this past year were 16.3 million. That's the shipments to the stores and through the SLO process. And the deliveries we made through our network to the stores totaled 35,000. This slide here is talk a little bit more about the physical distribution of our product. I mentioned the 248 suppliers we have, and you probably have heard in business about the old 80-20 rule, where 20% of your suppliers are account for 80% of your business. That's definitely true here in Pennsylvania. Of the 248 suppliers, 26, the largest, account for about 85% of our product. And these are the big corporations. They've been getting bigger and bigger through industry acquisitions, consolidation over the years. As far as international sourcing, we source from over two dozen countries around the world. And as far as our logistics operations, we have three warehouses, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, and Scranton. That 16.3 million cases I mentioned, that's over 13,000 trailer loads, and we deliver about 130 orders a day. If you look at the next slide, which is a world map, it shows you where we're sourcing products. Every line means we're buying products from these countries. So every populated continent in the world we're buying from. So this is just to indicate where the products are coming from. The next slide, which is the U.S. slide indicating domestic sourcing, the thickness of the line is indicating volume. So you can see, obviously, California is an enormous source of products coming to Pennsylvania. But the smaller, thinner lines indicate we're also buying from those parts of the country. And then we have distilled products with a different color to show where they're coming from. We need to mention, too, that we also support Pennsylvania wineries. There's about 275 of them in Pennsylvania today. We're proud that we partner with the PA Winery Association and the PA Department of Agriculture in promoting PA-produced wine. Last year, we supported October Wine Month in Pennsylvania through the association. They saw a nice 30% increase in sales. We provide them help in listing their products in our stores to help them build their businesses as we go forward. The same situation on a smaller scale is happening to the distillers in Pennsylvania. This is a fairly new phenomenon in terms of the growth of craft and micro distilleries. In Pennsylvania today, we have 30 of those, and the number has been growing rapidly. We've implemented a PA preferred program for these distilleries, helping these small businesses to get their products listed in our stores so that they can grow their business. And then the last part of this is, we use all modes to move product to Pennsylvania. Internationally, we're shipping containers on ocean vessels. From California, we're shipping containers on the railroads. And then there's obviously a lot of over-the-road tractor trailers moving product into Pennsylvania. As far as our three distribution centers, we use XTL. These are all privately held companies in Philadelphia, Cane is Able in Scranton, and Genco in Pittsburgh. Mentioned we deliver more than 16 million cases last fiscal year. These three warehousing companies today provide 228 private industry jobs. They are not PLCB employees that work in those distribution centers. And then this past year, we paid those three companies just under $47 million. XTL in Philadelphia, we supply Philadelphia County and the collar counties, Bucks, Chester, Delaware, and Montgomery. It's 167 stores. We delivered 6.1 million cases. XTL has 60 jobs working down there, and we pay just under $18 million to XTL. On a volume basis, this is our largest distribution center, obviously because of the population. DC2, Cane is Able up in Scranton, has 235 stores across 32 counties in central and northeast PA. Delivered 5.6 million cases. They have 70 jobs supported by our contract, and we paid $15.3 million to Cane is Able. And last but not least, Genco in Pittsburgh serves 228 stores in 30 counties in western PA, delivered 4.6 million cases, and they have 68 jobs that are linked to our contract, and we paid them just under $14 million in revenue. The next slides are to focus a little bit on transportation, because I've spoken already about the 80-20 rule, that we buy so much of our product from 26. suppliers, but there's still over another 200 that we're using. How do we get the small shipments from the West Coast to Pennsylvania? And that's what this slide is meant to explain. What we do is we've hired what's called a consolidator. It's a company in Sonoma, California that aggregates all the small shipments from all up and down the West Coast, from Washington, Oregon, all through California, and generates truckloads to ship to us. The idea being, if they had to do it individually, the freight costs would be prohibitive, but by consolidating into a single truck, they can all share in truckload rates, which is by far the cheapest way to ship product. So this is an ongoing thing that goes on year-round. We buy a lot of merchandise out of the West Coast, and Grosskopf has been playing this consolidator role for us for a long time. We also have another consolidator, not near the scale, but here in what we call the Mid-Atlantic Consolidation Program. That is basically a lot of wine comes out of New York State. It's coming down to North Carolina. There's wineries we're buying from in that range. So they're consolidating from those parts of the country and shipping into our distribution centers. The same principle occurs internationally. We have a consolidator called Hildebrand that does our international consolidation. So when we have small winery purchases from France, Italy, Spain, wherever in the world, they're consolidating them into ocean containers to ship to us. They'll come into the ports in the Northeast, or in the case, if it's coming out of Australia or New Zealand, it comes into LA and gets railroaded across the country to Pennsylvania. So that's how these two slides are meant to show how we can work with small suppliers to get their products to market and do it efficiently from a transportation standpoint. Just like to briefly address sales channels, and for the representatives, this actually has a little bit of animation which you won't see on your paper. From our distribution centers, obviously our biggest customer are the stores we ship to. This past year, 79% of our business went through our retail stores to retail customers. The next biggest channel is from our licensees. 21% of our sales volume this past year occurred through that licensee group, and their business they're picking up primarily in our stores. The next one is our online store. We have a specific store in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, that all orders go through our Fine Wine and Good Spirits website, and we ship direct to the person's home, a store if they choose to, or their business. That business is growing rapidly. It's something that we're working very focused on improving. This year, it got up. Our sales ended to be about $2 million, which was 100% improvement from the prior year. And what this store carries is 1,500 unique, hard-to-find products, both wine and spirits. So it's a business that we're growing and very focused on for the future. The last thing I'm showing you here is we've just started in the last few months what we call licensee direct shipping, where it bypasses the store. So it's still in a pilot phase, but the Rivers Casino in Pittsburgh and the Sands Casino in Bethlehem, we're shipping, in some cases, full truckloads direct from the warehouse to their premise, bypassing the store. It's for efficiency. We have a new online ordering system, which we're, again, close to rolling out, that these folks helped us design, where they can order online and they pay online and they get delivered. So we're very proud of this, and we hope to expand this shortly as we continue to work through the pilot. So this is a new service we're providing the state. And the last thing I'd like to address in this section is how special liquor orders occur. Special liquor orders are generated either by a supplier or a licensee. Primarily, there is some retail customers that buy it. They put it through the order through a web portal, which goes to the supplier. The supplier ships it to our store, and then the licensee picks it up there. This past year, you can see the volume statistics on your page. You can read them on the screen. It's key to note, I mentioned earlier, that we have over 47,000 SLO items that we're offering today. That's double the number we had 3 years ago. This past year, we had 11,000 new items be submitted to us, and we accept everything that's offered to us. So this is an area that's been growing rapidly for us in somewhat of an exponential growth form. Okay, the next, moving to part two, talk about bailment. This is a traditional purchasing arrangement. If you look on both the screen and the slide, the title to inventory in a traditional purchasing arrangement passes when the shipper or the supplier ships it to our warehouse and we receive it. At that point, the title of inventory passes to us. That's the traditional purchasing arrangement that's been around, you know, forever. It's where bill of ladings come into play, you know, signatures, those kinds of things effectuate the change of ownership. Bailment is a legal term used to describe a control state warehousing liquor still owned by the supplier. Remember in the prior slide where the title changed and we own it in the warehouse? This is a unique arrangement. This is something that's been used in private industry. It's been called vendor-managed inventory for about 30 years. This is nothing new. The control states adopted it several decades ago, and frankly, Pennsylvania was a late adopter. This was something, we were the last one to do it. The only control state that doesn't use bailment today is Wyoming. So that map that Tim showed you earlier, all those blue states are control states are using bailment. This is a very common phenomenon within the control state environment. The board made the decision in 2009 to move forward with this, and we implemented it in 2012. I want to emphasize something. In our system, we have no bailment fees. Many states adopted a throughput bailment fee. So if you're putting your product in my store or in my warehouse, there's a throughput fee. It could be 50 cents a case, it could be a dollar a case, it could be whatever. Remember, we have 16 million cases that moved through the system last year. The board back then made the decision they were not going to go that route. In other words, we would pay the warehousing cost and the trucking costs. We would not charge a throughput fee. What they did decide to do was put a incentive system saying, if you give us good service, and you have to have obviously a cap because you don't have unlimited space in the warehouse in terms of weeks of supply, everything is free in terms of what you move through our system. So that's what was adopted back in 2012. We had to make decisions on, you had to have some size to participate in bailment. You have to be able to generate a truckload. We have three warehouses in the state. It would be very inefficient to force a very small supplier to ship a small LTL order, you know, across country or from some other origin. So part of the decision of coming up with the 26 suppliers that are in bailment today, and that number's changed over time due to consolidation, they had to have enough volume to generate a truckload, and that was the criteria used. So this slide animates for the folks up there. Here's the key difference in bailment. If you watch what happens, when bailment was implemented, the ownership or changing of title of the product moved from the receipt at the warehouse to the point of shipping from the warehouse. So when our stores place an order, that's when the title changes and it leaves our warehouse and heads to them. That is essentially bailment, what I just showed you. It's a change of ownership of when you did it. The title changed. The benefits to the PLCB were significant. It enabled us to get a working capital reduction, meaning inventory, because that warehouse inventory is no longer owned by us, of approximately $100 million. It increased inventory turns in any business. High turn in inventory is better than a low turn. And it greatly increased service levels. It helped us increase collaboration with vendors. We work, the spirits and wine industry today, we work closer together with them than we ever have in planning our business, planning promotions, planning the holidays, everything that we do. It's worked out very well. And it also, this was not planned originally, but it enabled us eventually to repay to the Commonwealth an $110 million loan we had had since 1968 to pay for inventories. It was a floating loan to pay for working capital investment. The benefit for the suppliers, each bailment vendor gets to control their own inventory in our warehouse, and we are one of the largest customers in the country. There's no charge to them for doing that. We don't charge any throughput fees to them to do that. It allows them to get the inventory closer to a big customer. And being a former supplier, coming out of private industry, this is a key. They get to ensure 604 stores are always in stock because they can keep their inventory in our warehouses, and that was a huge win for the suppliers. This is the change, the next slide, showing the inventory and inventory turn change pre-bailment to post-bailment, and you'll see the immediate jump in inventory turns and reduction in the inventory dollar investment. This is a very key slide. I mentioned before, we did bailment to improve service levels. In the red box, you'll see pre-bailment what our service levels were, and they were not good. And we define service level as follows. And this is common in consumer packaged goods. For every 100 cases your store needs, how many can we supply them out of the warehouse? That's the way service level is defined. And if it's 90, then it's a 90% fill rate or service level rate. Well, back before bailment, the service level was not good. It had huge volatility, as you see, 70% up to 90. In the consumer packaged goods business and in retail, 95% is considered good. So we did not do well. And so bailment, part of the reason was to help fix this problem. When bailment was implemented, which is the middle box, you'll see the rapid improvement in service level and the volatility decreased, so the range decreased. And now here we are 3 years later. We're now, frankly, at world-class service levels, and the suppliers are getting their products sold at the highest rate they ever had in our store. We achieved what we wanted, so we're very, very pleased with that. That's the end of the bailment part of the discussion. Okay, now I'd like to switch to the markup structure discussion. Wanted to take this slide to start it off because I think it's important to frame the rest of the discussion. This is our financial results from last fiscal year. Our sales were $2.335 billion in sales and tax revenue. Of that, $1.281 billion is the cost of goods. That's what it cost us to buy that product that we eventually sold through the system. Then there was the 18% liquor tax collected. That equated to $334 million. Then the sales tax, which was $139 million this past year. And then what's left over is what we call gross profit. That was $581 million. And the key here, I think, to explain is this is paying for store operations. Our store operations this past year cost us $338 million. This pays for all other admin. This is our headquarters organization. This includes IT. This includes everything we do to run the business, marketing, supply chain, et cetera. The next two are important because these are things that we're paying for that we don't necessarily have control over. First is we're paying for the PSP, Bureau of Liquor Control Enforcement, regulatory costs, the ALJ, all those things. And that $30 million figure is the net after fines. So after the fine enforcement fees are collected, that's the net we have to pay for out of our profits because they do not correlate at all. We're paying, I think it's $44 million for these functions in the state. And the fines, et cetera, were collected were $14 million. So it's a $30 million gap that we're funding out of our profits. The next one is comptroller and other services. This would be auditor general charges, office administration charges, comptroller and DGS. Those are all charges that parts of the state that we're paying for. The net income figure, which is the last number of 117, that's the, I skipped the alcohol education grants of $2 million. The net income figure of 117 million that's left over, that's after everything is paid for. That is essentially the pure profit of the agency after all that occurs. The statutory provisions regarding pricing for the PLCB. The PLCB is authorized to establish the wholesale and retail prices of liquor. One of the key phrases in that statute is prices must be proportional with prices paid by the board to its suppliers. So the practical effect of that is whatever markup structure is applied to a product, the same markup structure must be applied to all products. That's how that has been interpreted since it's been written. Oh, I'm sorry, I missed a slide.
No, you didn't.
On the screen, I mean.
Oh. You didn't read this one?
I know, I know. The pricing components are made up of two main things, and that is the PLCB's share of the markup, and the secondly is the 18% liquor tax. This tax is embedded in the PLCB's markup structure and reflected in the retail shelf price at all stores. It is collected daily as part of our retail sales, and then at night it is swept daily from our liquor fund over to the general fund. That's how that works. State and city sales taxes are obviously assessed on top of the retail prices, that's the 6%, and the Allegheny and Philadelphia sales taxes. So that's how the pricing is set up. This chart is meant to reflect, this is the formula we use for the pricing of our products. In our research, first off, let me say this formula has been developed over decades. In looking at other control states, many of them have similar looking formulas with multiple steps along the way. Basically, you take the vendor's product cost, there's a 1% markup, then the 30% standard markup, an LTMF value, which we'll be talking about a little bit later, then the 18% liquor tax, and then there's a rounding effect. You know, as you probably know, most retail products are at end at 99 cents or some 9. So if it's somewhere in between, normal retail practices, you round it up to the 9. And that's what that means, the rounding factor. And that creates your retail shelf price. So we thought an effective way to do this would be to show you, and we tried to explain it at the House Appropriations Committee hearing back in the spring, but it was this was a chance to maybe put it make it a little more clear how this works. The way that Pennsylvania works is the suppliers, we have a markup formula on our website. It's basically an Excel sheet that says it calculates all the factors that go into the purchase price versus the selling price on the retail shelf. The way the system works today is the supplier will come in using that formula on our website. They'll decide what they want to retail it at. So if they're going to choose $19.99, the system calculates backwards to all these components. And all suppliers use this, wine and spirits. So it ends up showing what the cost of the supplier is. So in this instance, in this example, it's showing that if the supplier wanted to have a $19.99 retail, what they compete at on the shelf, and all retailers have to factor in their competitive positioning of their products and those kind of things, this is how the system works. There is no arbitrary application variation to this. We follow this thing religiously, and this is, in fact, what our suppliers use, this markup formula on our website. The left-hand side where the bottle is simply to show you the delineation of how much is the PLCB's markup, the various taxes, and the other components of the cost. We have very similar, it's exactly the same formula with another example using wine. I won't go through that, but this is exactly the same formula. As far as supplier price increases, I'd like to address this. Vendors may change their prices 4 times a year. We have a process 4 times a year where they can come in if they so choose to raise prices. We don't require why. We just simply, if they want to come in, they're doing it for their own competitive reasons. They have their own MSRP, manufacturer suggested retail price. So they're doing things for their benefit, which is what manufacturers do. When the supplier prices go up, the PLCB has to pay more for the products. And as a wholesaler and retailer, PLCB has similar cost pressures as private industry, but it has limited options to address these increased costs occurring in our business. I'd like to talk for a second about regulatory costs as it applies to this. In fiscal year 13-14, the costs associated with funding the enforcement operations of the PSP's BLCE, our licensing functions, the ALJ, the Office of Chief Counsel, totaled $44 million. But the revenue derived from fees and fines totaled only $14 million. I mentioned that before. This left us a deficit of $30 million, which continues to grow every year and has to be subsidized from our net income, resulting in reduced revenue for the Commonwealth. And I'd like to add that licensee fees and fines have been at their current level for more than 2 decades. I'd like to switch to the fourth part, which is a discussion of the LTMF. When we were first informed of this informational meeting, we were advised that concerns had been raised regarding the adjustment to the LTMF that was approved by the board earlier this month. and we'd like to take this opportunity to provide you with a better understanding of the LTMF itself and also the decision that occurred. Why did the PLCB make an adjustment for new products, and how will this change affect the prices of new products moving forward? The LTMF is one component of the PLCB's markup structure. It's added, not multiplied, after the percentage markups are applied. It's intended to recover some of the inherent costs of handling products, warehousing, trucking, merchandising, and retail costs. I thought it was important to show you a timeline, and I'm not going to focus on the old stuff, other than to say that the PLCB has had a handling charge back to at least 1955. That's as far back as we can actually find the records that there's been a handling charge. Over the decades, it's changed terminology, but from the records we can find, it was a way for the board to recover its handling costs of moving products through the supply chain for eventual sale at the retail level. I'm highlighting that box I put around the 1993 to 2015 period. Is 1993 is the last time the board made a change to our 30% markup. It's been static for 22 years. And then it was the last time it had an increase to its handling fee. At the time, it was called the OCC, which was called Operational Cost Component. It was the first time fees were set based on the size of the bottle and the product, whether it was a wine or spirit. So it was the first time it differentiated the costs, the operating costs of handling the product based on the size of the bottle and the product that it contained. In 2002, a very minor change occurred. There had been a bottle fee in this long-term handling structure that ended, and then there was a slight upward change made to the OCC in 2002 to offset that. Then in 2011, a significant change was made, changing the OCC to what we now call the LTMF, Logistics, Transportation, Merchandising Factor. And this change was as follows. All those fees up to that point were flat bottle fees. Simply at the time was a change to a percent. There was no actual cost increase to suppliers at that time. We changed the bottle fee to a percent fee, a flat fee to a percent fee. What it was intended to do, though, long term, was as vendors increase prices, that then our compensation or our, we would be able to recover some additional increases along the way. That's why it was done in 2011. Since then, there's been no change to the LTMF until this most recent change, which is one of the reasons we're here today. In early 2015, we realized that when we made the conversion in 2011, there had been no provision for handling new items entering the system after that date, reflecting vendor price increases or inflation. This resulted in a pricing disparity between items in the system prior to 2011 and new items brought after that date. This August 1st, 2015 LTMF adjustment corrected that disparity. And I might add that that board meeting that approved the August 1st effective change was given to the vendors 40 days in advance. Okay, the next is a chart showing the actual changes to the LTMF that occurred as effective August 1st. So you'll see on the right-hand column the cents impact the different sizes of wine and spirits that occurred. I think they were ranging anywhere from 5, 7, 6, 3, 3, 7, 10, and 22 cents. Again, those disparities are driven by the size of the bottle and type of product that they're in there, wine or spirits. In planning this adjustment, we examined the possible cumulative effect of the adjustment on new items based on the new items that came into the system last year. We used that as our model for, okay, what's the impact to pricing? We determined that the impact on the PLCB's net profit was negligible. Depending on how we measured it, it was between $68,000 and $100,000. Let's talk about the impact of that change in terms of a percent of our total cost. Remember, we bought $1.3 billion in product this past year from suppliers. This is 0.008%. That's 0.008 of a percent change to our pricing. It was a very minimal change, and it was done only to correct what occurred in 2011, which we did not factor in a way to handle new products coming into the system. It was changed back then. It was an oversight on the LCB's part. So this is a minimal change, very small, and that concludes my presentation.
Okay, thank you very much. I have a number of questions, but I don't want to dominate everything here. So before I do, I did want to just point out that we had the majority staff here has done a nice job putting together a couple of exhibits that we have in front of the members here, and I've distributed to the members and also the testifiers. And I did want to make sure that we went over those briefly. First of all, on the distribution, and I've used a restaurant in the example that we had here, and you see delightful little trucks going over a up and down hills across that. And I'll just ask you about the current system, and it does look to me like it matches up with the model that you've shown me, but is that look to you accurate as far as the current system is concerned?
Yes, the upper half of that chart is reflective of the great, great majority, other than the licensees, the couple casinos I mentioned. That's how the system works today.
Okay, thank you. Now, before I'd seen your testimony, we went through the process of trying to build up the various charges, both those that are flat and those that are percentage-based, on a typical 750-milliliter bottle of wine and then similar to a bottle of spirits. And that's the other chart that we have here. And it looks a bit different from your exhibit. So I wanted to have give you a chance to go over that also and take a look at it and see if you have any disagreements about how we've put that together. Because we will be using it as an exhibit for the other testifiers as well, and I thought you ought to have a chance to discuss it.
I'm sorry, I can't see it from here. I'm
a paper copy.
Yeah, we did provide you with copies, and I'd be happy to share mine with you if you
the
want.
The only comment I would have is that the rounding of 53 cents, taking it from six, and I'm looking at the wine.
Yep.
Probably the rounding, I believe, would take that to $16.99. I don't believe that we'd take a 53-cent rounding.
That's
we'd
correct.
Take that to round it to the nines would take it to $16.99, not taking it to $17.49.
We were told that you did not round less than 4 cents, and that if the product came in at a price that was 3 cents, in other words, 96, 97, or 98, that you would round up to the next highest rounding item, which would be the following 49 cents. Is that not your policy?
Our policy is that we round up to the closest 99. So in this particular situation, we would round this one up to 16.99.
So you don't have a 4 cent limit on the rounding?
No, we don't.
And you don't round to 49 cents?
We do round some products to 49 cents, but very, very few in the system. It's generally luxury wines. We will do that, but it's a very small percentage.
And in what case would you round to 49? If it was less than 49,
to 49,
but more than 99, you would round up to the 49, and that's the only circumstances under which you'd do that?
Correct.
Okay. Any other issues with the chart that you see?
I'm advised that the LTMF factor that's in the is it the top one should have been $1.26. That was our error in giving you that information, Chairman. I'm sorry, it's the bottom one.
Okay,
it's our error giving you that the other day.
I'm going off of your letter to the vendors from July 28th, 2015 right now. Do you have that letter with you?
No,
you familiar
I don't.
With it?
Familiar with it. We don't have to.
Okay. I'll just quote off of it. And I don't know if it's inaccurate and you wish to reissue that letter or change it, and you know that you need to do that, if you want to share that with me now, I certainly will take that into account. But just reading what I'm seeing here, you have a limit of spirit fluid ounces at 25.4. And when I did my math to try and turn my 750 milliliter bottle into fluid ounces, 750 milliliters is the equivalent of 25.36 fluid ounces. The chart clearly states for 25.4 up to and not including 25.4 that that it would be at $1.26. So that would be less than 25.4, so I would assume it would go down to the lower category of $1.12.
If I can, I'd like to ask our Director of Marketing and Merchandising, Dale Horst, to explain this letter.
Okay.
Thank you, John. In the chart, was the chart that was established back in 1993. The 750 for spirits actually goes to the $1.20 figure and has been increased to $1.26. The equivalent of 750 in that chart, that up to ounces is a little misleading, but all of our 750 wines have an LTMF of $1.20 prior to August 1st and $1.26 after.
Well, I don't understand, in a very simple reading of this, and obviously whenever we set up standards, we have to make them clear to the vendors. So if it says up to but not including 25.4, should be at $1.12.
The only thing I can think of is that 25.36 was rounded up to 25.4.
And did you state that anywhere in your information to the vendors?
No, but the calculator that was sent along with it with the vendors all realized that the 750 is calculated at an LTMF of 120 and then after August 1st of 126.
Okay. It seems to me that there ought to have been more clarification on this because when I went to school, 25.36 was less than 25.4.
Mr. Chairman, you're absolutely right. There should have been more clarification, and the letter was premature as well.
Well, then I assume you're going to clarify it later then. Thank you. I'm going to recognize questions from, committee staff. Chairman Costa, do you have anything at this time?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John, in the end of your testimony, you're saying that this increase will create $100,000. But what does it, including $100,000, how much would you generate in a fiscal year?
How much would we generate? That $100,000?
With the LTMF.
That $100,000 would be the increased cost of the LTMF on an annual basis, and we said depending how we ran the numbers, it was between $68,000 and $100,000. We ran it a couple different ways trying to model the impact to our business, so that would be the net increase.
But what I'm trying to figure out is if, according to your testimony, the three warehousing units, you pay them 17.9, 15.3, and 13.7. If my math is right, it's 46.9 million. Is the LTMF coming close to covering those costs?
The LTMF in total, the LTMF in total, Warren, was about 200 and some million for the whole business. In other words, the execution of the business today generates $235 million. That's the total LTMF fee for all products moving through the system. One thing I want to clarify, this change that we talked about with the LTMF on August 1st was for only new products coming in after August 1st. All products in the system prior to that have no change.
Okay.
Just want to clarify that.
Thank you.
And just if I can add, there's certainly other costs when it comes to the LCB in terms of moving the product. You know, the warehouse cost is, as in John's slides, of $46 million. There's still, you know, our logistics and supply chain and so forth and so on costs that are internal to the LCB on top of that.
Thank you.
Okay. Representative Sonney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have a couple of quick questions. In the beginning of your testimony, you stated the increase in sales. What do you think is driving those increased sales? Have you made, you know, different marketing approach, or there's no?
That's a great question. It's a hard one to answer, but I'll tell you what we believe is happening. Certainly, our bottle ring has been going up, meaning the average price of what consumers are buying. So we came out of the recession when we clearly were negatively impacted by a downturn in bottle ring. It's been going back up. People are buying a little bit better wine, a little bit better of distilled spirits. We think that's part of it. We think we're doing a better job in the stores of keeping the store shelves filled. The merchandising is better. We're improving that. Certainly, we do get a piece of the vendor increases when they put them in. Remember that price compilation that I showed you? We get, I'm rounding this off to roughly a 25% impact of the dollar that they raise. So all those factors are helping us improve our sales, and we're very pleased by it.
When it comes to the LTMF, you have the ability to change that on your own, correct? You don't need legislative approval to adjust that.
Correct.
That's correct.
And just on a final quick question, we saw through your presentation how you, you know, like assist the California wineries with the shipping to be able to fill trucks and ship those trucks full. You know, what do you do for PA wineries? In other words, is it just simply up to the PA winery itself as an individual to get their product to all three distribution centers? Is that the way that it works?
It varies depending on the winery. The larger wineries in the state will ship directly and go through the warehouse network because they have enough volume. We give them the option of what they do. So they can either do that, or for the smaller wineries, what they usually will do is they'll pick a number of stores in their locale. They'll say, I want these 10 stores in York and Lancaster County because people know the brand name in that area. And many times that winery will actually just ship the product direct to the stores because the volume is small. So it's all the above in terms of how we handle PA wineries. But we do it in a way, frankly, to try to help the new wineries, you know, get their business going by listing their products in our stores, giving them the option.
And are those decisions more of the local decision to keep that shelf space for those local wineries? Or
yes. Yeah, we're in the process now. I mean, we've always had PA sections in our stores, you've seen. We're in the process now of changing them all, bringing that made in Pennsylvania up front in the store. We got rid of New York. It used to be PA/New York. We've taken that off the signage. So we're highlighting only Pennsylvania wines and spirits on that section. We're partway through the rollout of that, and it's occurring and should be done by the holidays this year.
And real quickly, just to get it on the record, your views on direct shipment of wine.
Our views on direct shipping
direct
of wine.
Shipment to consumer.
From out of state or
from out of state, or
what are you talking? Which direction?
Yes, in state, out of state, direct shipment to the consumer without having
taxes,
to go through the LCB.
As long as taxes are collected, Representative, if I can just add briefly, John was being a little modest here on our sales growth. One of the reasons that we're having sales growth is we have a great executive team under John's leadership, and we're always looking at ways to improve. Whether that be rebranding our stores, we've rebranded about 80. That shows considerable growth in our business when we do that. Trying to right locate stores next to grocery stores, we've been doing that across the Commonwealth. I believe we have 140, 150 that are within walking distance of grocery stores to make it more convenient for the consumers. And that all goes into why our profits are going up, and that's a great leadership team.
And on direct shipment?
Well, first
we agree. Let us do it.
And we do it now.
Just to follow up on the chairman's comments, we should. Right now, we have wine experts in a lot of the stores. Being a Southeast Pennsylvania resident in Chester County, I can tell you, being 20 minutes from the Delaware border, the stores that we've rebranded and put next to the grocery stores and have expert people in there with our employees are now preventing what I call border bleed. So a lot of people are coming to me now and saying, we don't go there anymore to Delaware. We're really happy with these new stores you're putting in. Keep doing it.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Petri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the detailed information. Just a couple follow-up questions, if you have some information. You talked about 16 million cases going to the LCB stores in the last fiscal year. Do we know how many of those cases or what percentage are were sent to the stores for restaurants?
I don't have it for restaurants specifically. I do have licensees, which restaurants is a high percentage, and that was 21% of our sales. I don't have it broken by cases, but I can easily get that, Representative Petri.
And do we know how many employees we have in the system who are dedicated to that function of delivering the product to the licensee?
For the casinos that I mentioned?
No, for all of the licensees.
Okay,
so in other words, what's our labor cost associated with delivering to licensees at the store?
Okay. The licensees, to clarify, the licensees pick up the business, pick up the product at our stores with their own people or with a contract trucker or somebody like that. So there's nothing on our end there. Our employees are not dedicated in our stores to doing just licensee business because it happens all during the workday, all during the 6 or 7 days a week that they're open. So employees handle it along with everything else they're doing in the store.
But some percentage of their time is spent in delivering that product as opposed to waiting on customers. Have you ever analyzed what your labor cost is to get the product to the licensee?
We've never tried to separate that out.
Is it possible to do so?
We could go through an analysis, yes. That's about like a time analysis, yes.
The pilot program that you're rolling out, is the intent to change? Is the goal to see whether a change should be made and that at least with regard to licensees, the delivery system would look more like the bottom as opposed to the top?
Yeah, our desire would be, and we're told by our council that it requires legislative change to be able to do that, but our desire would be on the SLO business to be able to ship direct to the licensee's premise or consumer's premise. That is our desire long term, yes.
Okay. For the consumer, have you ever done an analysis that would show the markups that we had in the one exhibit and how they may compare to the ultimate consumer state by state? In other words, is our system more expensive for the consumer, equal on general, or less expensive?
There was an analysis done, I'm going to say, about 5 years ago, and I've seen the results. It was done by, I believe it was Nielsen, where they compared it, and it depended on the product. Some products were more expensive and some were cheaper, and it all depended on the state.
Is that something you could share with the chairman of the committee for our use?
Sure, absolutely. We are considering redoing the study given its age, and that's something that we were planning to talk to the board about. That's something we'd like to do again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Harkins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. It sounds like you've made a great effort to obtain stock products from PA wineries and distilleries. To piggyback with Representative Sonney, we both have wineries in our area. I'm not embarrassed to do a shameless plug for many of them up there. But can you discuss the programs or initiatives you have instituted to help them market their products in PA? And if we divest from the PLCB of its ability to determine the products that ought to be sold, they are pretty much on their own, aren't they, to find private wholesalers to buy their products?
The board made a decision 2 years ago to participate with the Department of Agriculture in what's called the PA Preferred Program. That provides for marketing of the local wineries in the state. We also provided the vehicle for the winery to approach us to ask for their product to be listed, whether it's in just a handful of stores in their local market area, and we built the system to facilitate that. So we're trying both on the winery and the distillery side to actively promote PA wineries. In answer to your second question, that's hypothetical. We are trying to permit Pennsylvania wines to be listed. We're encouraging that to happen. If we do go away, obviously they have to find a retailer willing to handle it, and then that becomes, you know, speculation as to whether that would occur. I honestly don't know. But we do purposefully try to help out the wineries and distilleries in the state. That's done by design.
And Representative, we do that geographically.
Okay.
Because obviously there's a lot of small wineries that don't have enough volume in order to go to 603 stores. And we have found out that geographically people want to buy wine from their region in Pennsylvania. So whether it be your region or the regions throughout Pennsylvania. So we're trying not only to help them, but also help them in a way that they don't sell product to us and we put it in stores not in their given region because they cannot supply that much.
And like I said, we're off in the forgotten corner, but we've got some great great products up there. One other question. Do other states assess a bailment fee? And it sounds like the suppliers are able to use the fee. The free warehousing service is paid for by the Commonwealth, and your operational costs keep going up every year. Is that something that you think we should be looking at as a possible revenue option?
Most control states do charge bailment fees. I mentioned this, they run roughly between 50 cents and a dollar per case for every case put through there. The board made a conscious decision in 2009 when they approved the program not to do that, but simply to build an incentive system to incent great service. At this point in time, we think we've achieved with the industry that goal, and the one graph we showing the superior service levels. So from my vantage point, I will not be advocating a change to a bailment fee structure. If the industry wanted it, we'd look at it, but I don't believe they're going to want something like that. So that's my opinion. The board members may have a different opinion, but that would be my recommendation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Payne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Ross, Chairman Costa, thank you for holding the informational hearing. Chairman Holden, Congressman Holden, thank you for bringing the team here today. A couple of questions, and actually I got to give credit to my colleague, Representative Petri. I almost called you Chairman Petri. You're right behind me. He and I have had this topic for the 13 years we've been here. How many warehouses do we currently lease in New York when the stuff's offloaded off the ships and stored there before it comes down to our three distribution points?
The only properties we do business with, and they're done by contract, we don't lease anywhere, are the three DCs that I mentioned. We lease nothing out of state. We have, for example, Hildebrand. I mentioned that was our international consolidator bringing product from Europe. They're based in New York City, but they have operations around the world. We pay on throughput fees per those contracts. So the cases they move is how they bill us. We have zero leases outside the state of Pennsylvania.
So the question we're trying to get at is if it comes off the ship in a container in New York and it's shipped directly down to one of our three centers, or Hildebrand holds it somewhere and then it's shipped down to one of our three centers?
Yeah, what happens
is... The second part is true.
What happens is when the container comes off the ship and is offloaded at the port, in Hildebrand's case, they'll actually bring it into a warehouse they operate,
yeah,
consolidate product to bring truckloads to our three warehouses.
All right, so politically, we're not renting them, but they're still being stored in New York somewhere. My point is, we tried 13 years ago to look at unloading all the ships that we purchased product from in Philadelphia. And the argument was at the time that the Delaware wasn't deep enough, it couldn't handle the ships. We know we're dredging the Delaware now. I'd like to know an analysis of whether the cost to unload our ships in Philadelphia is competitive with New York, the cost to store them in somebody's warehouse in New York would be competitive to storing them in somebody's warehouse in Pennsylvania. The point I'm trying to drive at is it's Pennsylvania liquor should be coming into a Pennsylvania port and stored in a Pennsylvania warehouse prior to coming to the LCB's warehouse. If that analysis has been done and you could give that to us and it's still substantially cheaper than do it in New York, I think I accept that.
We agree, and we would like everything to be unloaded in Philadelphia. Unfortunately, bailment is a restriction to that. Maybe you can elaborate on that, John.
Well, remember the change of ownership that I showed you. Prior to bailment, we controlled the freight coming from anywhere. In other words, we were paying the trucking. When bailment occurred, the transportation cost inbound switched to the supplier. So they went from a, what was called an FOB origin price, in other words, it was priced based off wherever it was coming from, to an FOB delivered price, which is now the freight is built into their freight cost or into their product price. So we lost visibility when that change occurred to where the freight's coming in. A lot of the merchandise that we still control does come through Philadelphia and Chester ports. But the stuff that the majority of the product, which is what was the bailment product, we have lost visibility to what ports they're coming through. We don't know.
So we would need a legislative change to do something on that to require if it's coming to Pennsylvania, it comes in through that port.
We would have to do an analysis. Representative, when I was chairman 2 years ago, I spent a lot of time in the Philadelphia port area being a Philadelphia native and spent a lot of time with the Port Authority talking to them about how we could move product through to Philadelphia. Back then, as you know, the dredging was taking place to increase the depth of the port to bring more product in. The difficulty that we ran into, besides bailment, was the cost of bringing it up the Delaware past Wilmington. That the fact that a lot of the container ships were not coming up that distance because of the extra cost of going up there, as well as the extra cost of waiting to be unloaded until the Philadelphia Port Authority increased its ability to unload quicker. So they were not ready to do that. The other issue we had was a lot of ports are coming in through the west, San Diego and whatnot, from Chile or some of the other locations, because they would then go into San Diego, which has a deep water port, and truck across the country. I, for one, would really push to try to get more through the Philadelphia port, but you'll find out we'd have to do some analysis as the cost of it, because they were saying the cost would increase to a point where it would make the liquor prohibitive to the consumer.
And I appreciate that. If you could kind of work on an analysis, update the analysis. I mean, if that's true, then I'm not from Philadelphia, but I'm pro-Pennsylvania jobs. Then I would be talking to the Philadelphia delegation that they should be talking to the Port Authority and figuring out how we cannot be competitive with New York. I mean, that just seems hard to believe that New York's cheaper than Philadelphia. But I appreciate your analysis. The next question I have is, I'm from Hershey. We have a state store and a grocery store in Hershey. Been there for, I bet, greater than 20 or 25 years. Came in as a Fox's. It's now a Carnes. It's under the same roof. There's a separate entrance and exit way. I'd be interested in knowing whether that's a profitable model. And if it is, I hear what your testimony was today about you're doing things down close to Delaware. But I've always wondered, years ago when they did that, if it worked, why we didn't do more, and if it doesn't work, why do we keep signing the lease? So if somebody later could get back and just say, yeah, the Hershey store opened in this year and it's pretty profitable and, you know, we think that's a good model. And I want to follow up with that. You know, I've been out of state and I've looked at these superstores, and they can be Southern Wines, Total Wines, John and Scott's Wines. It doesn't matter. But you walk in the store, and it's this huge building that has one-stop shopping. And I wondered whether LCB has looked at hooking up with one of the major beer distributors in Pennsylvania and having the beer distributorship here and an LCB store next to it. I mean, people literally then can go to one spot and do one-stop shopping. The point I'm driving at is we have a store right now that, thank goodness, the lease is up and they're not renewing it in Middletown. It is in a mall that is the worst location you could find in that mall is where our state store is. The mall itself is old, needs modernization, has no red light to get in and out. I think the giant grocery store is looking at moving. So I'm trying to see the vision, if we keep the system we have, that we're looking at getting out of some of these terrible locations we're in, number one, and number two, that we're looking at doing superstores. Some kind of place that it's not the typical we have. I don't know how many stores we have in Dauphin County, but we don't have 27 stores. We have 12 stores, but they're super stores, and you're willing to drive there because here's what you get when you get there.
Representative Payne, I do want to intervene here because we're running late, and I did want to mention also that we're working on the wholesale distribution side rather than the retail. We may have discussions about retail stores in the future, and I certainly would encourage you to take that up with the members directly.
I appreciate maybe another hearing on the retail side. But
absolutely.
Thank you for the correction, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, if you can get back to me separately, that'll be fine.
I'll come to you.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry I went off topic there a little bit. One last question on the other side of the coin, and that's the flex pricing. I mean, we looked at the 30 plus one. Is that a 31% markup? I always thought it was 30, but I saw the 30 plus one today.
It's a multiplier effect, as the poster shows you here and what we put on the slide. It's the purchase price times 1% times 30, so it's slightly over 31% net
effect. All right. Here's my point. I'll make it brief. 30 or 31 or whatever the percent is on a cost to you of a $3, $4 for a bottle of wine purchase, $2, whatever it is one number. That 30% on a bottle of wine that costs you $50, $40, $60 is another number. And I know we can't pass along some of those costs in the higher-end wines, so I'm wondering if we've ever looked at a flex pricing scale so that the lower-priced wine could have more flexibility than some of your higher products. And I only bring that up on that side, Mr. Chairman, because I know my father used to run the merchandise stuff for Hershey Park, and if we all knew what a baseball cap really cost, we'd be amazed. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I wanted to recognize that we've been joined by Representative Kampf, and thank him for coming. Representative Delozier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And on behalf of time, I just have, I'll just ask the one question you brought up in the presentation. Thank you for all the information, because it's always good to have a big picture. You brought up a lot of the numbers on jobs. With the numbers that you had mentioned, the 228 private jobs, that's, I'm assuming those are with the three contractors for the trucking, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And then we also have involved in this whole process is the PSP in the enforcement side of things that's employed by them. Underneath the LCB, we have admin and the stores and the warehouse. Those would be the three basic breakdowns. What's that breakout of the 5,000 for the employees?
The great majority, and I don't know if any of our group knows the exact figure, the great majority are the store employees, like the around 3,500 to 4,000. The balance of the employees are located in the headquarters a couple blocks from here.
Right.
And we have a couple regional offices around the state where alcohol education occurs and the other licensing functions that we do.
Okay, and then the warehouse?
The warehouse, we have two of our own employees in each of the three warehouses. That's the extent of our...
That's it.
So
is that so those two people run the entire warehouse?
These are our people. They don't run the warehouse. The contractor runs the warehouse, but there are on-site people to manage to make sure that the stores in that region are getting the service they need and give direction to that third party about initiatives that we want accomplished.
Okay,
for the warehouse.
In my mind, when I hear warehouse, I think of a lot of different employees. So I just want to clarify that. And then the admin, so you're basically saying there's about 1,000 admin, give or take, running the operation here in Harrisburg. Okay.
That's correct.
For the breakdown. Okay, thank you very much. I just wanted to clarify on all the jobs involved in this process. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Delozier. Representative Reese.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, thank you for your testimony. I appreciate all the information you provided. I have a question about LTMF, logistics, transportation, and merchandise factor. Representative Sonney had the question, is this controlled by the board completely? There's no outside influence on what that number is? It's at your discretion?
It's our discretion.
So given that I would argue, and I think most would argue, that there is no real private sector competition here, and that it is a completely controlled state from wholesale to retail when it comes to wine and spirits. How do you determine what that number should be? What do you base your decision off of to determine whether or not that's appropriate, whether it be too high, too low? Could you give us some insight as to why you think the current number that you just set is appropriate? And while you're doing that, I noticed it said on new products, could you tell me what that means when you say new products? Thank you.
Remember this slide, I'm actually still up there, showing the slight differentials from prior to August 1st LTMF to after August 1st. That's the difference, those 2 5-cent, those different cent amounts that are up there is the difference. The LTMF was built over many, many years. Remember I mentioned it started as an operational cost component, and then it was moved, it changed over time to the different changes that I mentioned in that chronology. It's been built over time. It does not begin to cover all of our costs, but it all originated without a handling fee many, many years ago and has morphed over time to what we have today.
Thank you. So it's an arbitrary number. I guess I just want to understand the logic. I mean, look, in the private sector, I think we all understand how pricing works. You know, you have to compete. And if you're not competitive, your product's not going to move. We have absolute control in this state of wine and spirits, and it's under your purview. And again, I certainly respect the work you've done. I guess I'm just trying to better understand how you determine what is appropriate and what is not appropriate, whether it be too high or too low when it comes to the LTMF.
Representative, you have to remember the industry sets the shelf price, and then we back in to what the cost of the product will be. And then we have to figure in the cost of our logistics, our warehousing, our transportation, and so on. And that's how we engage in that.
And it affects the wholesale price at that point.
Got it. I guess, and I don't mean to be difficult. Again, I certainly respect the work you gentlemen do. But the statement was made that it doesn't necessarily cover your costs. Correct. So if you could just give me the thought process behind how you determine what that number should be, I'd really appreciate it.
That question you're asking is a good question. That's a question that I've asked internal. Having a factor like that with the various percentage fees, is it in fact reflective of our costs today? That analysis has not been done, as far as we can find, for a long time. This developed over many decades. It morphed, it changed during the process, and frankly is something we should look at, but has not been done to date.
Thank you very much.
Bottom line is that we're netting around 5.5 to 6% in net profit, which in comparison to a Walmart, to a Wegmans, to other retailers along those lines, is a little bit superior margin than you'll find in those major retailers. So I think that all of those factors come into play in terms of margin, and to be honest with you, we have the ability of changing the 30% margin if we wanted to. That doesn't take legislative action. So I think when you're looking at what all of our total costs are, we're trying to find a fair and equitable, obviously you guys want $80 million a year too. So there are certain costs that we've got to cover, and that's what LTMF is part of our markup, and just no different than what our other markups are as well.
And to follow up on that, you would like more than $80 million. The difficulty that you run into is that if we tomorrow, as Tim and I were the board members last year for a while, just the two of us, and there was discussion in the building about changing the markup from 30 to 32%. That obviously was brought over here and looked at in a very, very difficult, negative way, and we didn't do it. Now, that markup hasn't changed since 1993. There isn't an industry in the United States that has not increased pricing since 1993. Although the industry has increased prices since 2011 on liquor for about 1,600 times. We have not done it at all. So the LTMF, the way I see it, history-wise, back to 1955, was a way of creating some number to offset expenses, but that number has not kept up with inflation either. So my opinion would be, if you're going to move down a direction with the LCB of making it profitable, and either do away with the LTMF or make it a number that makes sense to offset the expenses, then the other question you have to look at is the proportional markup. There's always a fear that somehow this board will become greedy and we'll end up making more money than we should. I would suggest to you that has not occurred in my tenure, and if the legislature would take a look at some of that stuff from your perspective, even though we have the right to do it proportionally across the board, we have refrained from doing that, not to cause issues with the legislature and obviously with the industry.
Operating the business over there, we would welcome a simplification of our pricing structure that's on the poster over here. But as we saw with the change we made August 1st, it causes a lot of disruption. It causes a lot of issues with the industry. But we would welcome the opportunity to work with both the spirits and wine industry to simplify that structure.
So thank you for your response, and I certainly appreciate that. And I think you went through a process that is somewhat reasonable given our current state here and how we sell wine and spirits. I guess I would just put on the record, I think it would be better left to the private sector, and then we wouldn't even have to have these conversations. Thank you very much for your service.
Representative Schweyer.
Chairman Ross, thank you so much, and I appreciate your flexibility. This conversation has been really helpful to me, and so just a few questions and thoughts sort of popped in my head as we went along, and I promise I'll be quick because I know the agenda is getting tight. Gentlemen, so the conversation that or the philosophy that the private sector pressures don't exist because you don't have competition perhaps on the retail side, from your perspective and what you've been saying to us may not entirely be accurate, or it's just a different perspective, because those private sector pressures are there between the providers, the manufacturers of said wines and spirits, correct? So if whiskey producer A versus whiskey wants to sell at $19.99, and whiskey producer B wants to be competitive with that person, they're going to have to be at roughly the same site. So is it fair to say that that's where the private sector competition comes in, that's where the private sector pressures come in to try to keep prices at a reasonable level?
Well, I think in the private sector, the various retailers would certainly price themselves competitively.
Sure.
But as you see in quite often in the grocery industry, where you'll find between two competitors, the pricing is virtually the same. So you may not see significant changes. You could see more aggressive promotions, for example. We can't do promotions in our due to the legislation. I can't lower a price to do a Valentine's Day sale, which we'd love to do. But in private industry, they could have loss leaders, which they do in the grocery industry, sell it below cost.
Okay.
We don't have those kinds of options today. So certainly those kinds of things would come into play to some level.
All right, thank you. And then is it fair to say when you develop your price on the retail side, and I promise this relates to the wholesale side, that you don't so much determine the price as you do set the formula that allows the industry to back into it? So if you would reduce, and you're shaking your head yes for the record, so made the decision to change the 1+30% margin to a lower number for whatever reason, now we're losing, you're going to be losing not only profit, that a portion of that is returned to the General Assembly, but those costs are covered, in large part, cover the other fees that you could assess, bailment fees and so forth and so on. So really, one way or the other, it's either we reduce the profit that the PLCB makes and therefore returns to the General Assembly, or we increase other fees, which ostensibly does the exact same thing for both the supplier and the consumer.
Yeah, if we focus just on the pricing formula and we lowered a component, that's lowering the revenue back to Pennsylvania. And it lowers the purchase price from the supplier. So basically every piece of that pie gets reduced if we take it down. If that occurred and we wanted to go the bailment fee route, that would be a possibility, certainly. But always the biggest generator of revenue to the state is going to be the product itself.
So you either maintain that 1+30 or you reduce it, but you increase your other fees to get to some other, and we can do an analysis on that. We can do a million analyses on that, but that ultimately is the bottom line.
Ostensibly, yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and I know we're running over, but I did have a couple of points that I was still a bit unclear on. First of all, the 1% markup, sort of funny, we have a 1% markup and a 30% markup instead of a 31% markup. And you'll note on my chart, which was based on what I'd been told, that it was a prompt payment discount. Is it not a prompt payment discount?
It was a prompt payment discount some decades ago. I don't know, Chairman Ross, the
origins. So in other words, if you don't pay in prompt promptly by your standards or somebody's standards, you don't forego that 1% discount.
At some point decades ago, that became part of the pricing
Fair
formula.
Enough.
I don't have a good answer.
And so if I understand correctly, the product is to be paid and becomes your property once it leaves the wholesale warehouse on its way to the retail store. How quickly do you pay?
Our current payment terms are 60 days.
And are you meeting those payment terms on a regular basis?
As far as I know, I'd have to check with our comptroller, but that's the terms we operate under.
Okay. So 60 days from the period of time that it leaves the wholesale warehouse. And you're turning over the inventory fairly promptly. And I imagine you're delivering promptly to the retail stores. Is it possible that you're actually being paid for the product before you pay the vendor?
That is possible, depending on the velocity of the product, yes.
Okay. And then you mentioned a good service incentive for inventory control. What kind of positive incentive do you offer the vendor? Do you give them some additional monies for the good service incentive for inventory control?
We don't provide any positive incentive. What we do, as I mentioned before, we do not charge them any throughput fees or bailment fees, which most other states do.
Well, could you describe the good service incentive for inventory control that you mentioned earlier? What is that?
The incentive we built for the suppliers was a structure that said if you hit various levels, and we have velocity categories. A velocity is the fast moving products, Captain Morgan, Smirnoff. We have an incredible skew
right.
of our A velocity going like this. A lot of slow movers in the system. The A velocity, the products we want to keep in stock all the time. We never want to run out of those kind of products. We have a high expectation level for service. And if that's not met, there's actually a penalty fee assessed against the supplier.
So it's a bad service penalty rather than a good
yeah,
service
it's a bad
incentive.
Service, okay. Yeah.
Just wanted to. Language is important. I was trying to get some of this stuff cleared up.
Yes.
And finally, you're saying the vendors have control over this process. You were mentioning that. Do they? They obviously have responsibility to ship into you. Do they have any actual control over when it leaves your warehouse or how it's actually managed after it gets to your warehouse? You mentioned that you have a management firm that's running your warehouse, and you're also indicating to them when things are going to be shipped. So once it comes into the warehouse, once they ship in, do they pretty much lose control over the product at that point?
When it's in our warehouses, we have it on our perpetual inventory. The volumes they're bringing in, we work on shared forecasts with the supplier to determine how much they should be bringing in. And depending on the A, B, or C velocity, we have extremely liberal valuations, how many weeks of supply they can carry in the warehouse, up to 8 weeks of supply on those A's, so that if you have a week where sales spike for whatever reason, you got more than enough buffer inventory to carry. We also then have forecast based on history the sales at each store in the system. So the withdrawals going to the stores are based off historical records. So it's forecasted in, forecasted out. We built very large buffers.
That wasn't my question, just so we get clear on that. I understand how you're doing the projections. I was asking about control. You were saying that they had a good deal of control over this.
They have control in the sense of making sure the product's in the warehouse.
So they ship it in, and once that happens, then they lose control.
That's correct.
Subcontractors that are controlling.
That's correct.
Okay, and then just my final comment. I know you're making a distinction between the LTMF and a bailment charge. And language, as I mentioned earlier, is interesting. I can understand a handling fee when you're handling something. You actually figure out the cost of taking that particular size quantity product through the process. And I think that's where this originally came from. And it made sense, obviously, when this was totally owned by the Liquor Control Board when it was coming into your warehouse. But right now, and you don't have to agree or disagree with me, but I'll just say this for the record, it strikes me that the LTMF is a bailment charge. So. So we can agree to disagree on that then. All right. Unless there are any other questions, I want to thank you all for coming. I appreciate you taking the time. You did a great deal of effort, obviously, in putting together the presentations, and you gave us a lot of information, much of it which was new to us. So I'm very grateful for that and for the time that you took in doing it. And we appreciate it, and we'll be obviously further in touch if we have other questions or if we have other areas that we want to further explore. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we are running behind, but our next panel is a panel of one person for the Wine Institute, Terry Kofer Byrne, Eastern Council.
Can they join me?
If you want to merge the two panels together, that's fine. That would help us. We have the Wine Institute, as I mentioned, with Terry Kofer Byrne. And then the next panel after that, which they apparently are comfortable sitting next to each other, is the Distilled Spirits Council of the United States, Dave Wojner, the Vice President of Office of Government Relations, and David Osgo, Senior Vice President, Economic and Strategic Analysis. And at this point, we'll recognize Ms. Byrne.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee.
Excuse me, you're going to have to pull the mic closer, and I hope it's on.
Okay.
You need to, but for the test fires, you need to be about an inch or two away from those mics.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me now?
A little closer still, I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. This is Terry Byrne. I do represent the California wine industry, more than 1,000 wineries and affiliate members. Together, the industry produces 90% of all domestic wines, and as you saw from the big red aorta across the United States, we provide PLCB with more than 50% of their wine products, both in dollars and in volume. California wineries have a unique relationship with Pennsylvania. As was mentioned, Pennsylvania is a control state for wine, which is unusual. There are actually only three states.
You can pull it a little closer.
There are actually only three states in the country where the state controls both the wholesale transaction and the retail sale of wine. So Pennsylvania is unique with New Hampshire and Utah in that regard. Wine Institute, Representative Sonney is a great supporter of direct-to-consumer wine shipments. Thank you, sir. However, we took no position on whether Pennsylvania should privatize their PLCB operations. We generally support increasing the numbers of outlets where wine can be sold to consumers in Pennsylvania. Wine Institute spends most of its time in Pennsylvania monitoring the pricing activities of PLCB. And at the risk of being redundant, I'm not going to read you my testimony. I'm just going to touch on some of the highlights. I think PLCB did a fabulous job, frankly, of explaining their pricing formula and how they operate, and it's the best I've heard since I've been watching their activities for 7 years. One area where we would like to see some significant changes with regard to PLCB is having some greater transparency related to the pricing activities of PLCB. I have to remind you that wine is an agricultural product. You don't just flip the switch or turn on the burners and it comes out. It's an agricultural product. We're facing drought, we're facing forest fires, we're facing all the traditional pressures of agriculture, and we set prices a year in advance, if not longer. So pricing is quite a sensitive issue for us. There are 3,000 wineries in California, 8,000 wineries in the United States these days, and nearly 200,000 products in the marketplace in the United States. So pricing is very sensitive. As was mentioned, the PLCB's shelf prices are set based on a complex formula of things they can change and things they can't change. The taxes you set, everything else they set. The markups and the fees are what we spend a good deal of time trying to understand. They have a pricing calculator that they use, and as you've heard from some of the questions today, we know the components of the calculator, but oftentimes the actual numbers are hard to discern. There's some a lot of areas where they have flexibility with regard to rounding and the LTMF fee particularly. So I'm going to focus my remarks on some of those. Since 1987, the Liquor Code has required that the pricing, that the LTMF be proportional with the prices that the board pays to its suppliers. That term proportional is going to be a hot buzzword in thinking about PLCB going forward. What it means is that 30% markup that you saw in the formula can't be changed. They can change it across the board to 32% or 33%, but each product in their system has to be marked up 30%. That's what their chief counsel has told us in a written opinion, is they don't have any flexibility with regard to pricing. However, they don't always follow their own rules. Since 2003, with wine products particularly, any products that cost more than $65 at wholesale, they mark up that first $65 by 30%. But if it's a $100 wholesale product, that additional $35 is marked up only 10%. So they are marking up a portion of the wholesale cost by 30%, but the remainder by something different than 30%. So while they suggest that they don't have the flexibility, and indeed they have used some flexibility in the past, which is the reason why Wine Institute is opposed to any allowance for PLCB to have what they deem flexible pricing. I'll note that flexible pricing is not variable pricing. You've considered that before, where you can have one product in two different stores and it's priced differently. That's variable pricing. The issue on the table today is flexible pricing or market-based pricing, which means they can vary that 30% markup on either individual products or individual classes of products. So all Scotch could be marked up at 25%, or instead maybe premium brand scotches, or wines in my case, could be marked up at a different amount. So we are opposed to any authority to PLCB to have flexible pricing, because that 30% markup is the only consistent factor in the pricing formula that we have any control over. And as was mentioned, we do set the retail prices because we look at pricing in the national marketplace. And we have to back out all these factors to get to the wholesale price. That's the only thing we have the ability to negotiate with PLCB over is that wholesale price. There is no requirement currently that the shelf prices right now, that any savings that PLCB realizes from negotiating with my suppliers, there is no requirement that PLCB pass along those savings to consumers right now. If flexible pricing is allowed, any discounts could be absorbed into PLCB. They propose no criteria for deciding on which products it might choose to alter the markups or how long those different markups might last. And we have a fear for a threat of higher markups on one product in exchange for a cheaper wholesale price on another. Remember, my guys are not selling one brand of wine. They're selling 10 brands of wine to PLCB. So one product can be used to play off another one. With regard to the LTMF, the logistics, transportation, and merchandising factor, the definition of that term has morphed a little bit, I guess. In 2011, they did convert the LTMF from a flat fixed fee per bottle handling fee to one that was based on a percentage of the price. So it became, as we requested price increases, which we are allowed to do four times a year, or price decreases for that matter, it was just a price change, then the LTMF would change. In the 4 years since that's happened, apparently 56% of all of their products had price changes. So they looked at the LTMF and decided most recently that they would adjust the price of all the products to the average of those 56%, which resulted in an increase in the LTMF that they described most recently. Specifically, they sent a memo to the suppliers in June, on June 23rd, notifying everybody of this LTMF change. We started asking some questions about it, and we're told that the board had made a decision to increase the LTMF, but there was no record of the decision. And ultimately, on July 15th, the board voted to approve this, and we were told that as part of the policy, the board was going to revisit this LTMF fee on an annual basis. We don't have any indication from the board minutes or anything that that's their plan, but we've been told informally that they're going to revisit the LTMF on an annual basis. In 2012, they implemented the bailment system, the warehousing system they described earlier. The 26 now large suppliers that sell 80% of the PLCB's products are in the bailment warehousing system. The remaining 15% of those suppliers, the remaining suppliers that sell 15% of the products are the ones that are remaining in a true pure invoice system. So there's two billing systems being maintained in PLCB. You saw on the slide presentation that they are responsible for the consolidation of products that move across the country. Well, my suppliers, many of whom are in those 26 large suppliers, they're not using consolidators. Remember, the reason they're put into bailment is because they were selling a certain volume of product. So there are two systems being maintained, and we question the inefficiencies from this unnecessary distinction between invoice products and bailment products. The LTMF has morphed from what it originally was to what we see now is comparable to a bailment fee. There's been a discussion about bailment fees and whether they charge them. It's my opinion that they don't have the authority to charge bailment fees, that you would have to grant them that authority. And the LTMF was created to accomplish those very, very items that the LTMF pays for. On the back of the napkin numbers I was just generating, the LTMF total that they generate was $235 million. And the price for the three distribution centers, which apparently is the only place where they're storing our product before they go to the store, is $47 million. So there's the LTMF is generating $188 million. We're not sure what that revenue supports related to our products. There was a mention of some comprehensive evaluation of the LTMF pricing structure and some justification for the numbers used in that factor. We would be thrilled to participate in such a broad overview analysis of the LTMF and all of the other factors that go into the pricing formula at PLCB. We have encouraged the creation of an industry advisory group and others that might help them from a 30,000 feet perspective, take a look at the way they price their products. And so we'd be thrilled to assist with whatever efforts you might encourage them to undertake to look at their pricing structure. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions, sir.
Okay, and I think since you all agreed to be in the same panel, I'm gonna go ahead and represent and allow our next testifier, Mr. Osgoe, to go next, unless Dave Wagner.
Sure, Mr. Chairman, thank you. I just want to introduce myself to the committee, Mr. Chairman, Representative Koster and Ross. Thank you. David Wonar, Vice President for Control States for the Distilled Spirits Council. As you may know, we're a national trade association that represents roughly 70% of the world's market share. I have the unique perspective working for National Trade Association to work in the 16 other control state jurisdictions. And as a National Trade Association, we have a number of resources available to us. Our companies have invested in that, so when we present to you, we have multiple opportunities to present information. With that, while most people feel comfortable with their lawyers, we feel more comfortable with our economists. So we have brought our chief economist, David Osgoe, up, and he will be providing most of the testimony. But I do want to say for the record, we think that HB 189 was great. We think the bill sponsor was great, and we think it would be greater if distilled spirits was ever added to it. Thank you.
I want to apologize for butchering the pronunciation of your last
name.
Okay. Maybe isn't the first time it's happened. I don't know. Mr. Asko, please go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. David always introduces me as the industry economist and says I'm here rather than the lawyer, and it makes me wonder, do people prefer listening to economists or lawyers? I'll leave that up to you. I'm going to truncate a lot of my testimony. Much of it has been covered already. We know that the LTMF was raised. It was moved from a fixed rate fee to a variable rate fee a couple of years ago. This makes it certain that the LTMF now keeps up with inflation. So to a large extent, every fee now charged by every fee applied, markup or fee, varies with inflation for the PLCB. Now, obviously, we were against the change to the variable rate markup fee, variable rate LTMF. The PLCB did it at their discretion. What I'm going to show is that we believe that the current markup formula, the LTMF coupled with the 30% or 31% markup, should generate adequate revenue for every bottle of spirits sold, and given these services that the PLCB currently provides. Theoretically, the PLCB acts as both the wholesaler and retailer of wine and spirits in Pennsylvania. However, compared to private sector wholesalers, the PLCB does very little of the work that a wholesaler is expected to do. One of the basic functions of wholesaling is to deliver products to retail accounts. While a PLCB does deliver to its own stores, it does not deliver to the 15,000 on-premise accounts throughout Pennsylvania that sell wine and spirits. Delivering to large case volumes to state stores is really the easy part of wholesaling. It doesn't cost much more to deliver 100 cases of a product to a state store than it does to deliver one case to a restaurant. To efficiently deliver to small amounts to on-premise accounts for the real challenge in wholesaling, and it's something that the PLCB simply does not do. In fact, taken in percentage terms, the PLCB does not serve 96% of its customers, i.e., those 15,000 retail accounts. Another function of wholesaling is inventory management. Private sector wholesalers will make certain that they have adequate supply, and not only supply, but the right products. The PLCB, in going to a bailment system, essentially has outsourced both the inventory management as well as the inventory carrying cost. As part of the bailment system, the PLCB, as was brought up earlier, has also instituted a series of penalties and fees that suppliers will have to pay for either having too much or too little product. Ultimately, even the simple warehouse operations and delivery that the PLCB does provide have been outsourced long ago. Thus, the PLCB's contribution to wholesaling in Pennsylvania is really to act as a middleman. So essentially, they're almost the middleman for the middleman, since they really don't supply. They themselves do not provide any of the actual wholesaling functions. Given the greatly truncated wholesaling services that the PLCB provides and the new revenue that the PLCB will generate from bailment fines, it is difficult to see why the PLCB needed to raise the LTMF in the first place, and we are opposed to any further increases in the LTMF or the markup. The other component of the markup formula that the PLCB lays claim to is obviously the 30 or 31% markup. In the private sector, the retail markup has traditionally been around 25%, though this 25% is usually applied at the wholesale level. However, this 25% today is the average, really, only for small and medium-sized package stores. While the spirits industry was once dominated by small package stores, that is really no longer the case. Half of all states today allow sales of spirits through grocery stores. In fact, there are some very, very large national package store chains. Some of the large package store chains have an average markup on spirits that's as low as 10%. And some mass retailers have markups that are even lower. So when you look at what the PLCB currently receives, the services that they offer, they should be more than revenue adequate. It should be more, that revenue should be more than adequate to supply, cover their cost and supply a good return to the state of Pennsylvania. Like it or not, we live in a world where efficiency is valued and margins are often slim. The people of Pennsylvania should not be punished because the state is in the wine and spirits business. If the legislature wants to be fair to the PLCB's customers, increases in the LTMF and the markup should be off the table. Further price increases will only cause more Pennsylvanians to shop across the border. While the wholesaling operations and pricing pose some challenges to the PLCB, the biggest challenge for the system is the lack of retail outlets. As I mentioned earlier, consumers desire reasonable prices and good convenience. The success of Sunday sales in Pennsylvania shows the importance of convenience. Obviously, Sunday sales did absolutely nothing to make the PLCB more price competitive. All it did was made shopping more convenient. Well, the same thing would happen by expanding the number of retail outlets. So if the legislature really wants to help the PLCB and to help the consumer, it should find a way to increase the number of outlets. Across the U.S., there are an average of 3.8 spirits outlets for every 10,000 adults. In control states, there are just under 1.8. But in Pennsylvania, that number is 0.7. So effectively, Pennsylvania could double the number of outlets it currently has and still not reach the average of other control states. Research shows that there are tremendous sales gains to be had by getting the number of retail outlets up to the between 2 and 3 per 10,000 adults. Now, there are ways to increase the number of outlets that I'll be happy to discuss with any committee member that would cost the PLCB little in capital outlay, and it would that also give the PLCB great flexibility. But for now, I'd like to leave you with a message that nobody ever built a retailing empire on being the high-cost provider. And in today's modern economy, it's the consumer that demands convenience. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And you violated the Payne rule of getting into retail a little bit, but I, since I let him go a distance, I let you go a distance too.
I appreciate it.
All right. Representative Costa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I like the Payne rule. That was pretty good. Terry and David, for that matter, when you were here for John Metzger's testimony, he said most other states do charge a bailment fee. But my question is, we don't charge a bailment fee, but do other states charge a handling fee and a bailment fee, or one or the other, or neither?
It's my experience in the other control states, and predominantly spirits are in the control state systems, is that it's either a bailment fee or nothing. And as I think as Terry mentioned, I believe it's in order to get a bailment fee in Pennsylvania, it would require an act of the legislature. So for instance, in Mississippi, there's a bailment fee. It was set by the legislature. And that was, 25 cents per case. So we believe it would require an act of the legislature to do that here in Pennsylvania.
Okay. Terry, have you found the same thing? By the way, thank you both, all of you, for being here.
Well, many fewer states have wine in the control system, but we see them as the same thing. Bailment and handling are synonymous, really.
Okay. Thank you.
Representative Petri.
Thank both of you for testifying today. David, I think you made the point that, at least what I heard, was that the LCB really isn't that heavily involved in the wholesale system, that it's still more the distributors that are handling that. So if you could refashion the wholesale system, what would your industry seek? Just broadly, would you prefer a commission-based system? Do you think some tweaks to the current system are better? And when I say better, I mean also for the consumer. I mean, obviously, your guys are entitled to make a profit, but also for the consumer.
I think one of the, speak to Pennsylvania, one of the big holes and the gaps in the system, as David alluded to, is the fact that the on-premise sector does not receive delivery. I mean, that's really the linchpin to this operation here, is that you've got an underserved on-premise sector, and that permeates every single community, every single legislative district. The more vibrant the restaurant industry is, the on-premises, that's better for the economy, that's better for the people putting them to work. So I think if there were to be some improvement here in Pennsylvania, number one would be providing delivery to the on-premise sector.
Anything else? What about as far as pricing and delivery? Terry, you mentioned the two different systems, and I think you made a good point that the there's part going through the bailment, there's part not, and is it really fair? You probably have customers that are in both systems, I assume.
We do. Whether it's fair or whether it's inefficient, that's one of the things that we're getting at. The LTMF is generating a significant amount of revenue, and it changes frequently. And it seems to me that the pricing formula has morphed. Another example of a piece of it that's has morphed into something that it didn't originally intend to be was the 1% prompt pay discount, which was mentioned earlier. It started out as a discount for payment within 10 days. Right now, with the bailment system, which from all indications has been relatively successful at doing what it was intended to do, which was remove a significant amount of inventory from the books of the PLCB, they're still collecting the 1% prompt pay discount. They're calling it a markup now. That's the first time I've ever seen it as a markup and not a prompt pay discount. And it's really not 1%. It's 1% compounded on top of something else. And so that's the challenge. We're looking for a much simpler pricing formula.
Ms. Representative, if I could just add to the answer to the question. I think you look at it probably through, you know, two prisms. One, if you had a private system, what would happen? You'd have to ensure competition, right? And that's why during the privatization discussion, we were adamantly opposed to what was referred to as franchise protection language, which essentially required wholesalers and suppliers to be tied, to be married. And if a supplier wanted to remove their wholesaler, they couldn't do that if that law was in place. So competition is the anecdote to, or the you know, the guarantees a vibrant private marketplace. But if you're in a controlled jurisdiction, absent the competition that has been alluded to this evening, the anecdote to that is to make sure and ensure that there is openness and transparency in every single policy along the way. So I think that would be part of the formulas, to ensure that there is openness and transparency. So vendors, suppliers, retailers, on-premise, state store employees, everybody knows what is taking place, members of the legislature. So that's how you ensure that competition, the, you know, openness and transparency is sort of the competition in the in a control state environment. So I think that would be part of an equation or something that we would insist on if the wholesale environment were to be improved under the PLCB's jurisdiction.
Thank you.
Representative Sonney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good to see all of you. This is a question, I think, for the entire panel, but when we talk about the Pennsylvania system and the way that the pricing works today, in other words, you're going to tell the LCB the price that you would like your product to sell for on the shelf, correct? And then, you know, you can do the calculations yourself, I'm sure, to get close. So in the end, you know what you're going to make on the sale of that bottle, regardless if it's wine or spirit. When you compare this to free market states, do you think that the markup that is currently in place in Pennsylvania is in line, or do you think your products, you know, are priced any different in other states because the markups are either greater or less?
I think that when you look at the services that the PLCB is providing, their markup should be more than adequate. Given that they really are just marginally in the wholesaling business, and you look at the services that they provide, you look at their 30% markup, retail markup, you know, you compare that to a 25% markup. The numbers aren't strictly comparable, but taking the fact that you have a number of large national package stores right now that have a markup of 10% or less. Again, as I mentioned, you have some large retailers that have a markup of 7% or less. And From the consumer's standpoint, what is he getting out of all this? Well, is there fairness to him? I think ultimately the markup formula that the PLCB currently has ought to be more than adequate for them.
Terry, do you think the same way?
Well, we set our prices, and we look at the prices nationally and regionally, and so we're happy with the prices. The challenge comes in with the PLCB's discretion backing out from the prices to the wholesale cost. And we're negotiating with a monopoly, so we don't have much leverage to begin with. And when these seemingly small changes in the markup, the factors within the markup change, and the consumer price is set, then we're losing our profit. So,
and then you have to wait for that time period of adjustment to be able to readjust again your price to make up the difference, correct? You have four times a year to adjust price.
Four times a year, we do. And sometimes the prices are increased and sometimes they're decreased for competitive reasons. Mm-hmm. One thing that was mentioned, PLCB has expressed some frustration in their ability to, well, one of the justifications for their desire for flexible pricing has been to put products on sale. I mean, if that's what they want, let's give them some authority to do that. They have a lot of authority to change prices at the board level today on closeout products, on Chairman Select, other types of products. If they need specific authority to put something on sale because they want to put it on sale, let's put it through a process where the suppliers can participate in deciding when it goes on sale, what the sale price is, rather than giving them the discretion to make that decision without the involvement of the suppliers.
And I might add, as a practical matter, today, all of our member companies, they will promote products throughout the year, and they will give the PLCB a discounted price over what they normally would offer in order to promote that product. So this kind of price promotion does go on all the time right now. Now, typically in the in a private state, if the supplier knocks a dollar off the bottle, the wholesaler might reduce his margin, and then the retailer might reduce his margin as well. So a dollar at the supplier level quickly turns into $2 or more at the retail level. So you have a much, much better price promotion. Everybody, you know, takes a little bit of a hit on the margin and the hope that they're going to grow their sales. So there is the flexibility right now for the PLCB to do price promotions, and our member companies work with them all the time in order to promote products.
Right. So in other words, you do that to move more product?
Certainly.
You'll just say, instead of $19.99 for that bottle on the shelf, we'll make it $18.99.
Right. You when you're selling at $18.99 versus $19.99, you're doing it in the hopes of selling more product, not in the hopes of...
And which, again, you said is kind of done universally now anyway.
That's correct.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Representative Kampf.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Really, just a couple of comments. Maybe the first one's just kind of tongue-in-cheek. I'm a lawyer, not an economist. You know, lawyers can actually explain things sometimes reasonably well, and other times they get lost in the weeds. Economists, I do sometimes worry, get quite into the detail, Laffer curve and all that kind of stuff. David, you didn't do that at all. It was quite understandable, so thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
The things that I noticed in your testimony, one is that you characterize the wholesale piece that the Pennsylvania government runs as a middleman of a middleman. You also said many of the average markups in the non-control states are about 10%, and we're at about 30%. And you also added that there's really not a lot of wholesale activity done by the state of Pennsylvania other than to charge fees. All of that to me, as a layman not involved in the industry that you're involved in so deeply, except in this oversight capacity on this panel or on this committee, it is just absolutely proof positive that we should not be in the wholesale business at all. I'm not asking a question of the panel. You guys have made your points quite clearly, but I think your points go right to the heart of the matter, which is this is highly complicated, highly market-driven, and a bureaucratic entity run by the state should not be involved in it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And Representative Costa has a follow-up before I ask my questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to follow up what Representative Sonney brought up. Again, Mr. Metzger explained to us that you come to him and say, we want to put this bottle on the price at this price. And then you back into what you believe that you can sell it to them and still make the profits that you want. Is that similar in other areas, or do you just go to them and negotiate the best price that you possibly can? And then my follow-up is, can you ask your other retailers to charge a specific price, or do you have any control over that?
Certainly. Obviously, our member companies, you know, there are various laws, but our member companies work with the wholesaler all the time, and that you have a very good idea of what the final retail price is going to be. When our member companies work with a wholesaler in a private state, it's a true partnership. In some instances, they'll have staff dedicated to certain products. So there is a lot of negotiation and a lot of back and forth and a lot of give and take. It's a true partnership. So ultimately, yes, our member companies typically, it's my understanding, are trying to make a price point in a given market. It's just marketing 101. Where do I want to try to slot my product with regard to the pantheon of prices?
Do you have the, I don't want to say the authority, but the relationship to say, you know, you're charging too much for this product, we need you to lower the price, or whatever the case may be? Like with us, when I say it's the Commonwealth, you're telling them this is the price you want and that's the price they sell it for.
I can speak in generalities as to what goes on in the with the private sector wholesalers and retailers and our member companies. I can't really speak to specifics just because those are obviously private negotiations.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I will add, though, in other control states and, not to pick a fight with the beer industry, that's not the point, but you look at its process. It's process oriented in the control state. So for instance, my charge as the vice president for control states is that I'm constantly going before control state officials and legislators saying, a markup is a tax increase. A fee increase is a tax increase. So if you look at the beer industry, which is in the sort of is in the private sector, legislatures oversee any increase to the beer tax. And I suspect here in Pennsylvania, I don't know when the last time there was ever a beer increase tax. Not that I'm advocating for it, but what I'm suggesting is that in a controlled jurisdiction, there is no real backstop for industry and for the consumer to ensure that prices or fees or markups do not increase in order to meet the operating expenses.
As far as the beer tax increase, Governor Rendell proposed that several years back and was booed by the General Assembly.
Thank you for putting my point.
We stand with that.
That's right. So if we look at fees, markup increases or LTMF increases as a beer tax would be, I suspect those would be booed as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. And with regard to wine, remember, there's only a handful of states where wine's in the control system, so most of our sales are within a pure license system. And there's another factor in there that's much more significant than there is in these three control states, which is the wholesalers. I mean, we sell our products to them outright. So there's multiple layers of negotiation. We're negotiating with them, and they're negotiating with their retailers who have the ability to do loss leaders and other things that don't happen in Pennsylvania. So the negotiations are really different in those licensed states by virtue of it not being a one-stop shop, if you will.
My turn. I did put this chart up on my right-hand side, which has now gotten tweaked a bit based on the earlier testimonies, as I did my best to understand, and I have some sympathy now with you all trying to understand how these prices get built up and whether 0.36 is less or greater than 0.4, and how we round, and whether 3 cents or 4 cents is going to be not, going to go up to the next number and so forth. But I did put them in columns for a reason, And, you know, I did separate out the dollars that went to the PLCB and the dollars that went to the Pennsylvania Department of Revenue. And I did that for a point, and you notice that there's a percentage down at the bottom of the dollars to the PLCB, because we constantly talk about a 30% markup. And these numbers are going to move around a little based on what we heard. The percent to you all is going to go up a little bit, perhaps, and it's going to be down a little bit to the wine. We've got wine and spirits here, I forgot. But basically, we're looking at something in the mid-40, possibly even up to 50%. And whether you want to call the LTMF a bailment charge, an LTMF a handling charge, it kind of works out to the same thing. It's all going into their ultimate markup, from the way I look at it. And language is important, as I said earlier. This looks to me like something more like a 45 to 50% markup rather than a 30% markup or a 10% markup that you might be seeing in other states. So maybe this is a question to any of you, but maybe Mr. Osgo particularly. This percentage then seems to me to be high compared to some other states. Was that your understanding too?
It would certainly be high compared to large retailers. When you look at some of the large package store chains, yes, it would definitely be high. Now, again, it's not completely comparable because don't forget the PLCB is not really providing all of the wholesaling services that would normally be wrapped up in the private sector. So as a result, the numbers aren't completely comparable. If you are looking at a small package store, obviously a small package store, less buying power, they're going to tend to have a little bit higher markup. They would probably be in the low to mid 50s as well. But then again, that markup over FOB is going to be paying for a lot more services.
Mm-hmm. And I guess that gets to my next question. I have two other lines of questioning. One is this discussion about control over the distribution chain. And again, from what I'm understanding here, you have less control in Pennsylvania over how the product winds up getting into the store, how it's handled. If I'm correct, if the product is broken in the warehouse, that's your responsibility because it's in bailment and it belongs to you. So you would see that you have less control and less opportunity to take advantage of making sure that the product gets through to the end customer in a way that would be advantageous to marketing it well and being able to give good service because you have these intervening elements of the Liquor Control Board. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that was easy. and then my final question is the 99 cents. And we have this rounding system in Pennsylvania, which I guess I'm starting to understand again differently than I did before I walked in the door today, because I gather 49 cents doesn't happen anymore, even though we were told that they did round to 49 cents before. Do you stick strictly to making all your products on the shelf end at 99 cents in other states?
You know, again, I have to speak in generalities because we don't control our member companies' pricing, far from it. It's a common retail practice to make something end in a 9. I've never done a survey in other states to see if it's ending in 99 or 49 or whatnot. I suspect that there are a lot of 99s. Every time I go into any package store, you do see a lot of 99s.
But it's not a strict rule. So if you're trying to make a product a little more attractive on the shelf, your choice in other states isn't just to go down a whole dollar. Right.
That's correct, yes.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know if this helps or not, but most recently in Virginia, which is a control state, they were tasked by the governor to raise revenue to fill their coffers, and they went to rounding to the 9s as a way to generate additional revenue.
Okay.
I'll leave it at that.
And when they say rounding to the 9s, they mean both 9s, apparently. Is that correct?
The highest 9, I suspect.
Yeah, I mean, you can be coming in at 53 and round to 59, or you can come in at 53 and round to 99, and it does make a difference in terms of things.
That's right.
It certainly does.
And it would strike me that if you're trying to provide a good price for the consumer, having a little more flexibility within that dollar to be able to price would be helpful in getting a product to the consumer at a better price. And although we were told that pennies don't matter that much, obviously pennies do matter a lot to you. The difference of 40 or 50 cents on a bottle of your product probably adds up substantially, both to you and would be, I guess, appreciated by the customer as well.
At the end of the day, it really is about the customer. And the more attractive we are to the customer, I think that's best for everybody.
Great. Any other final questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for two things, for your good testimony, and second of all, for single-handedly getting us back and even slightly ahead of schedule. So I appreciate your testimony and your efforts here today. And that'll bring us to our final panel, which is the Pennsylvania Restaurant and Lodging Association, Melissa Bova, the Government Affairs Representative, and perhaps you might want to, Melissa, you might want to introduce your other testifiers or have them introduce themselves. Melissa isn't going to join him up here. So, okay. Well, we can pull another chair up if you'd like now. All right. Well, gentlemen, maybe you have organized yourselves in such a way so that you know who's going first, second, third, and fourth. So would you just please identify yourselves in order and please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. My name is Ray Hottenstein, and Chairman Ross, Chairman Costa, and members of the House Liquor Control Committee, I'd like to thank you for allowing us to testify today regarding logistics and distribution system of the Pennsylvania Liquor Control Board. Again, my name is Ray Hottenstein. I'm the owner of the Greenfield Restaurant in Lancaster, and I've been a licensee at two locations for 40 years. It's a family business that we own and operate. We have a 17-year recipient of the Wine Spectator Award, so we do purchase and retail a number of good wine products. I'm also the past president of the Pennsylvania Restaurant and Lodging Association, and currently I serve as the chairman of the association's Alcohol Service Committee, which consists of members of our association that hold restaurant, hotel, and eating place licenses. Upon being contacted about this hearing, we decided that it would be a good time to poll our licensed membership and hear from them about the top items that they would like to see changed or adjusted with the current system in Pennsylvania. And I hope the feedback that I can share with you today helps you to understand some of the legislative initiatives that our members feel that need to be pursued. It was interesting today to hear the discussion and the opposition to the LTMF, which is one of our main concerns. It should be no surprise that pricing is the number one frustration of all licensees in Pennsylvania. The five levels of markups not only make Pennsylvania uncompetitive with other states, but make it difficult and sometimes impossible for licensees to resell the product at a fair and reasonable markup or profit. Licensees are not able to purchase wine and spirits from where we can get the best price. We're forced to pay whatever the state dictates with only a 10% discount. We truly need to have a wholesale relationship with our purveyor, the PLCB. We do not favor, as I said earlier, an increase in the LTMF. The second largest complaint we have heard from our members is the lack of selection and poor customer service that licensees receive when they go to their local state store. Many of our members in less populated areas have said that their store is not regularly stocked, and in some cases they have to wait weeks for an order to be completed or shipped from another store. The state stores are meant to serve customers, which we are, 20% of the business of the PLCB, and the staff are not equipped to provide the customer service needed for a licensee that's attempting to pick up and purchase thousands of dollars of products to successfully operate their tax-paying businesses. Selection is not the only issue with products at the store, but it's a constant problem for licensees that regularly order SLO products, which today we heard was one of the largest increases that the PLCB has had over the last few years. There are items that the PLCB does not handle, yet assess all five levels of markups on these products. This is the same product that a bottle that they assess on bottles that are on their state store shelves. We believe reducing the 10% mark, or reducing the 30% markup to a fair and reasonable 10% markup on these SLO products would take into account any administrative costs the PLCB would have, and it would be more than appropriate. In the past, licensees were able to, and I remember this back in the day, when Ronnie Waxman would, who was my salesman, believe it or not, and he would come to where I was in, many years ago, 25 years ago, 30 years ago, and he would actually deliver SLO products. And then they became smart and realized that if those products were delivered to the control state or the control liquor control board state stores, they would be able to assess that same markup, and that's what happened. So that went away. So it is possible to have that done, and it was done legally, but because they wanted to pick up the extra 30%, that's what happened. We believe that it's a, and we also believe in the direct ship of SLO items. It not only will save the PLCB labor and processing costs, but will ensure accuracy in the product and the ordering situations. Finally, over 50% of our licensee respondents favored privatization of the wine and spirit systems, and some for the following reasons. And I want to point out that we did not ask them to discuss privatization. We asked them for their top reasons or the changes that they would like to see. But overwhelmingly, over 50% of them responded they'd like to see privatization. And one would be for the ability to buy a product in a competitive market for the best price. We'd have a broader selection of products. And I'm always surprised to hear that under the current situation that they would that our members like they would like to have delivery. I would be concerned personally about delivery from an organization, and I have respect for them because I'm licensed by them. But I would have concern about them being able to fulfill the responsibility of shipping to my location. I'd want to know, because many times over the years I've gone to pick up our order, or my family is going to pick the order up, and the order is not properly fulfilled. So I'd hate to think about a Thursday afternoon when I get my delivery, and I would be short for the weekend. Anyway, be careful what you ask for. Customer service was another big concern about the variety of wholesalers. We'd like to have a variety. That way, a variety of wholesalers would give us competition. We want to take the opportunity to recognize the attempt to make positive changes by the PLCB for licensees. Mr. Metzger, John Metzger, has been an excellent addition. And truthfully, we have gone to him many times over the last few months since he's been here and asked to help, asked for his help in correcting some of the problems that we're having. And he's always been up front and has always tried to help us as much as he can. Unfortunately, it doesn't matter how many changes that you're able to make. We're competing in a retail market with the very same organization that regulates us. And it's always going to be a system that doesn't allow competition in a true wholesale and retail market. And because of that, the solutions that are truly needed will only come from a privatized system. I also want to interject real quickly on this, a looming crisis that is happening throughout our industry in Pennsylvania, and that is the lack of restaurant licenses. You're going to see in the next year to 2 years that it will be almost impossible for, number one, to get a restaurant license, and number two, to afford a restaurant license. I have two kids. They're both in this business all their lives. They're smart kids, hard workers. Neither one of them will be able to go out and buy a license and operate a restaurant and they have the ability to do so financially because of the fact that the licenses are now going $300,000-$500,000. And so I want to bring that to your attention today. I know this is off the record, not off the record, but off of what you had asked us to discuss. But I want you to know that this is looming right now. Within the next year to 2 years, you will not be able to get a license. My county, there's none available in Lancaster County. There's always been three, four, five, six of them. But because of the supermarkets legally purchasing an R license, and we agree with that, as long as they buy their R license and play by the rules, those licenses are being dried up. Therefore, the smaller guys that have made what the vibrant restaurant community, or made what the community is so vibrant with restaurants, we're not going to be there anymore. And the guys like me who've been it all our life, we're going to sell out. We cash out for a nice big number for a license, but there's not going to be anybody there to buy them or to operate and to have what is known as the restaurant industry as we know it today. So, but I appreciate that you allowing us to come up and discuss this, and thanking again for the ability for me to testify today on some of the issues of the Pennsylvania Liquor Control Board and the Restaurant Association. Thank you.
And we're going to go right down the panel, and we'll hold the questions for the end, because I suspect that some of you will cover other topics that might otherwise be questions. So please, whoever's next.
Thank you. So my name's Steve Wilde. Unfortunately, I don't have the same booming voice as my colleague Ray here, so let me know if you need me to speak up anymore.
Just as long as you keep it close to your mouth, closer okay. than you probably feel comfortable.
So I'd like to thank Chairman Ross, Chairman Costa, the entire House Liquor Committee for hosting us all for a discussion that's clearly very important to all of us in the hospitality industry. And thank you, Chairman Ross, for so astutely pointing to the lack of knowledge on this issue and creating a space where we can explore some of those informational shortfalls. So I think we've talked about a good amount of those as we've gone through the process today. But I do think there's been some confusion between retail and wholesale. So I'd really like to focus on the wholesale part of things. So again, my name is Steve Wilde. I'm the Vice President of Operations and Beverage Director for the Petri family of restaurants. We're a medium-sized restaurant group located in Philadelphia mainly, where we have seven licenses. And then we also have one across the bridge in Morristown, New Jersey. So I'm in a unique position where I see both sides very intimately. And I've been invited here by the PRLA today to share that experience and how things are different between the states. So here they are. Number one, when we place an order for wine or spirits in New Jersey, it's a really simple and really direct relationship with the distributor. We'll call them up, place an order for a case. From there, it's delivered the same way most wholesale interactions would deliver to our door, typically the next day, and with zero delivery charge. So in Pennsylvania, this relationship starts the same. You know, we'll sit down and we'll taste a wine with the distributor and say, okay, it's great. Please send us three cases. From that point, the distributor will send it to the PLCB on our behalf. We'll pick it up ourselves. And in doing so, we'll suffer a lot of the inconveniences and a lot of the issues that Mr. Hottenstein pointed to. Additional travel expense, additional time and labor expense. We do have the option of a third-party delivery service, which is also an additional expense. We get so many parking tickets picking up at our store at 12th and Chestnut in Philadelphia. The second difference is terms. So in New Jersey, we pay for products with terms. I think, you know, pretty standard for a wholesale relationship. It's 30 days credit for us in New Jersey, which I think is pretty market standard for other states as well. In Pennsylvania, we pay COD, which you guys know you pointed to. So this is something that in New Jersey, it's held over our heads. You know, if we slip on our bills, if we're not very good at paying our bills, we'll pay COD, or we're told that that's what's going to happen. PA, it's our only option. So we'll pay with a check, credit card, in person, before we're able to put our hands on that product, and then again, take it off the premises ourselves. And as you mentioned, the PLCB does set its own terms at 60 days with its vendors. So the third difference is sales tax. We don't pay any sales tax on these orders in New Jersey because it's a resellable item, a resaleable. In PA, as you know, the goods are subject to essentially double taxation. So we'll pay 8% in Philadelphia, 6% the rest of the state, I believe, on products that we'll be then reselling and retaxing at an additional 10% when it leaves our restaurant to the consumer. And I'm not sure I can think of any other relationships that are wholesale where we deal with that double taxation in PA. So the fourth and major difference, in New Jersey, we receive wholesale pricing. So this means we have access to pricing that is substantially below retail. And beyond these already lower prices, we also have options for huge volume discounts. So if I could distill everything down to one simple point in my testimony today, this would be it. There's no wholesale market for wine and spirits in Pennsylvania as we know it. And we need to fix this. Restaurants purchase alcohol in New Jersey the same way they purchase any other wholesale products, which among many advantages makes it cheaper. And why don't we enjoy the same privilege in Pennsylvania? Instead, we pay retail, which makes wine and spirits exorbitantly more expensive for us. So again, I think that distinction between retail and wholesale has been muddied a little bit. I think even the last panel, we heard so many good points on so many things, but I think some of the questions were directed towards the wholesale market and maybe responded with both retail and wholesale in mind. So to put it really simply, the difference, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, New Jersey for us is restaurants, wholesale, Pennsylvania for us is restaurants, retail. And we have this great visual aid, the poster. So in New Jersey, we pay that $9.90, so call it $10. That's our cost. We don't pay that markup, we don't pay the taxes, and we don't pay the sales tax. So in Pennsylvania, we pay that, we'll call it $18 with the change. So that's the difference we're talking here. In Mr. Metzger's example on the PowerPoint, we saw a number of different things. We saw we'll pay $11.60 for an item in New Jersey that lands at $19.99 here in Pennsylvania. There's a really quick flash of a slide that I was very interested in that we didn't stay on too long, but it was a bottle of wine, and that bottle was listed in Mr. Metzger's example as $4.70, which is what we'd pay in New Jersey. We'd pay $8.99 as a restaurant here in Pennsylvania. So there's another really major frustration that comes from this model, which is that in a wholesale system, the cost of a good is blind to the end consumer because there's a retail tier in between. For example, in New Jersey, the customer never sees that $10 cost. They can only buy at retail. And we talked in the last panel about if that's 50%, they can pick it up in a retail shop for $15 or maybe even $18, depending on where you're buying it. But in PA, a consumer can buy that exact same wine at the $18 that we pay for it. And here's the craziest part that I think for all these discussions that I've had on this, no one has... that I've known really understood this point prior. In a lot of cases, consumers pay less than a restaurant does. I did a quick search through the PLCB search catalog and pulled up three immediate hits on this. So demonstrating listed or the retail price, so the price that when it's on the shelf, a consumer would pay versus the SLO price, which is the main reason for the discussion today, as far as I understand it, the wholesale price. So, Rex Goliath Zinfandel, SLO would be $8.99. It's on sale right now retail for $6.49. So restaurants would pay $8.99 for it if we place an order through the distributor, and you could walk in off the street and pick it up for $6.49 right now. Benton Lane Pinot Noir, $27.89 for wholesale, $24.99 for retail. And then we have an Italian restaurant group, so we buy a lot of higher-end Italian wine when we can. And this is one I found out myself when I placed the order with a distributor and then saw it in the store. Nino Negri Cinque Stelle, $90 wholesale, $90.49, $73.49 for a retail consumer. So $17 cheaper for a non-restaurant. So there are hundreds, if not thousands, of examples of this. We should talk about the 10% discount that licensees receive. Ironically, that 10% is a standard retail discount in other markets, meaning that if you purchase a case in New Jersey retail, you'd get 10% pretty much automatically, which again reinforces that notion that restaurants are locked into purchasing from the PLCB in a retail relationship, not wholesale. So what can we gain from the addition of a wholesale tier in PA? Increased sales volumes, increased consumer satisfaction, a lower tax burden on a cornerstone industry of the PA economy, I think very likely an increase in tax revenue from those increased sales volumes, a more vibrant and dynamic restaurant scene and will allow Pennsylvania restaurant operators to work on the same level playing field as other states. Again, I'm thankful to all of you for engaging in such an important topic. I'm honored to have been asked by the PRLA to discuss my experiences buying in New Jersey. But the truth is, we really don't need to look as far as New Jersey to investigate the true root of our issues with the PLCB. I think we can just look at any number of wholesale models that are currently successful in Pennsylvania. So Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, and a lot of Pennsylvania, two of the country's most exciting culinary scenes at the moment. So let's look at how restaurants buy food here, wholesale. Pennsylvania has a national reputation as one of the best places in the country to enjoy beer. I'm not pro beer taxes either. We can look at how beer is distributed in Pennsylvania, wholesale. And these are successful models. So it's no wonder we struggle to stay relevant when it comes to wine and PA. And it's no wonder that we also constantly struggle to keep talented beverage professionals and restaurant operators in state. Rather than deal with a lot of the challenges that PLCB presents, they're leaving in droves to open restaurants in LA, Chicago, New York, San Francisco. And they're bringing revenue and tourism with them when they do. And I agree with Representative Payne's point on keeping business in Pennsylvania. I'm pro-Pennsylvania jobs, too. And I, for one, am not going anywhere. I like it here. And it's an easy fix. I think if we give Pennsylvania's hospitality industry what other states already have, the ability to purchase wine and spirits in a true wholesale fashion, we'll eradicate the undue burden and see Pennsylvania thrive as a result. Thank you.
Thank you to Chairman Ross, Chairman Costa, and members of the House Liquor Control Committee. Hello, my name is Jason Malumed. I'm the president and founder of Chalkboard Wine and Spirits. Since graduating from Cornell University in 2009 with a degree in economics, I have worked in the wine industry here in Pennsylvania, first at a small Pennsylvania winery handling their sales and marketing, then as the Center City Philadelphia sales representative for the third largest distributor in Pennsylvania, and most recently covering the entire state, both selling to restaurants as well as to the PLCB luxury division with my own wine brokerage, Chalkboard Wine and Spirits. About a year ago, I also expanded Chalkboard to cover on-premise and off-premise accounts in New Jersey. So in a relatively short period of time, I've been able to see and work with the PLCB in multiple aspects, as well as see how they compare to a private market such as New Jersey. While I have definitely seen improvements in in-store product selection and customer service for Pennsylvania consumers, the PLCB is still painfully lacking in many areas, most notably their treatment of restaurant licensees and the SLO wine department. Simply put, because of the PLCB's inefficiencies as a quote-unquote wholesaler of wine to restaurants, they cost restaurant businesses money due to their high prices. They cost my business and other vendors money due to the levels of red tape needed to go through to sell wine SLO, all of which is costing the voting public money by returning less revenue to the state than we should. Every wine sold as an SLO must first be registered and approved by the PLCB. While I'm all for the PLCB approving each wine to make sure only one vendor can sell it at a time, the issue here is simply that this process takes far too long. At its worst, in January this year, the PLCB had a queue that was nearly 6 months backlogged. You will recall at this point, the PLCB made the decision to shut down all new item introductions so they could catch up, which ultimately led to a massive public outrage covered in various news outlets. By these items not being approved in a timely manner, it is not just a minor annoyance for vendors like myself who cannot sell our wine. Every single bottle of wine I sell SLO is run through the PLCB's standard markup formula, generating the various taxes and revenues that are ultimately returned back to the state every year. By these items not being approved in a timely manner, the PLCB is causing the state to lose this money. After the massive backlog embarrassment in January, the SLO department sent an email to all vendors saying that moving forward, they would put efforts in place to ensure a 10-day or less turnaround time on new SLO item approvals. And what would these efforts be exactly? It turns out it was just a new naming convention, causing more red tape and more delays. During this time period of the rollout of the new naming convention, I had almost 75 pending items that I was already receiving orders on. Had I been able to actually sell these items, the state would have generated more revenue and taxes. After waiting for over a month for these items to get approved, I began to email the SLO department to try and expedite the approval process, only to get no response. Every week, I would email them asking if there was an update. Finally, nearly a month later, I received my first response from the SLO department, simply requesting that my pending wines follow this new naming convention. When I checked to see if any of these pending items had been approved, I instead found them all rejected. The PLCB literally turned down money for the state because I did not write Cabernet Sauvignon in the flavor slash grape variety field in the vendor portal. To me, this illustrates the exact problem with the PLCB being left in charge of quote-unquote wholesaling wine to restaurant licensees. If they have a backlog now during the summer, the slow time, what will happen in the fourth quarter once things get really busy? How much money will the state have to lose before the PLCB realizes that they need to take this issue seriously and come up with a plan to address these inefficiencies? Which brings me to my next point. Because of the PLCB's SLO pricing structure, they are hurting small businesses with their incredibly high, quote unquote, wholesale pricing, making it impossible to compete compared to states around us. Because I sell wine to restaurants in both New Jersey and Pennsylvania, I will give you an example. In New Jersey, when I sell to a restaurant, we have frontline one case pricing and then volume discounts. So for example, a wine might be registered at $144 frontline, then $132 per case on three cases, and then $120 on five. So if a restaurant wants to buy five cases at once, they can get it for the discounted rate of $10 per bottle versus paying $12 per bottle for just one case. But in Pennsylvania, things are different. Because everything has to pass through the PLCB, vendors must first register the wine as an SLO. Because each product can only be sold at one price, vendors now encounter the first dilemma. Do we register the wine at the frontline price, or do we artificially sacrifice our margin and register it at a deeper discount price to try and make the wine slightly less expensive for licensees, despite the fact that most restaurants are not incentivized to order more than a case, let alone a couple of bottles at a time, because the PLCB does not offer volume discounts? So while this wine might be as low as $10 per bottle restaurant cost in New Jersey, that same exact wine is $18.25 delivered, including all the taxes and fees, here in Pennsylvania after it is run through the PLCB standard markup formula. How can restaurants be expected to compete when their wines are over 80% more expensive in Pennsylvania? How can vendors compete on volume when the PLCB forces us to sell that wine at such a high price? It is a losing proposition for all parties involved. And we are all praying this order is not automatically canceled by the PLCB. When this happens, the PLCB employees are supposed to pick the goods out, mark them as return to vendor, and call us to have our goods picked up. This sequence, however, rarely happens. There have been many times when a several thousand dollar invoice of mine is at over 120 days past due, past the net 60 due dates, and we have not heard anything from the PLCB about why we have not been paid, only to go to the store ourselves, dig through piles of old, canceled wine that has been sitting in a non-temperature controlled store, and discover this order of ours that was supposed to be returned back to us months ago, but no one had done anything about it. The whole system is just incredibly inefficient and costs the vendors, restaurant licensees, the PLCB, and the public an innumerable amount of lost money. This nightmare situation could begin to be rectified with SLO reform. By actually looking at the numbers, we determined SLO pricing reform would at worst result in no change to the amount of tax revenue generated by the PLCB, with the potential to generate an additional $3 million plus, not to mention the huge positive in terms of utility for everyone. In conclusion, the need for change in how the PLCB handles SLO wines has never been more evident. After giving them several chances to remedy these inefficiencies, the PLCB has shown that they can no longer be trusted to devise and execute strategies that are in the best interests of the people of Pennsylvania. They have lost money for vendors, licensees, and the public for too long, and despite them promising to make things better, nothing has changed. It is time for pricing reform for SLO wines. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to thank Chairman Ross.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to move the mic over now and get it nice
there
and close to you, because you're on TV, so.
Okay, very good. Is that better?
That's much better.
Okay, I'd like to thank Chairman Ross, Chairman Costa, and other members of the House Liquor Control Committee for allowing me to talk about distribution, logistics, and selling wine in Pennsylvania. I'm Scott Braunschweig, a 35-year resident of Westchester, PA. I've spent 37 years in the machine tool industry and have owned a distributorship for the last 24. We sell large computer-controlled machine tools, robotics, factory automation to manufacturers in five mid-Atlantic states. So I have a lot of experience in the free market side of distribution. I founded the Artisan Cellar in 2010 out of my passion for wine. Artisans is a licensed importer distributor selling quality bottled wines from small artisanal producers, primarily to restaurants through the SLO program. We sell only through SLO. We really have no retail sales at this time. We helped get the sale of keg wine via SLO approved in 2012. And expecting tap wine to grow like craft beer, I built a 16,000 square foot facility last year for distribution, and we became a licensed winery to fill kegs. In terms of floor space, we're the largest kegging facility on the East Coast, and as far as we can determine, we're the second largest in the United States. We're just getting started, though. It's very, very small at this point, but we've got a lot of room to grow. We have many great opportunities before us. We just need sufficient profit to take advantage of them. I do want to comment that the people at the LCB have been very helpful to us as we've grown our business over the past 5 years. There are many positive to working with them. Getting paid on time certainly comes to mind, but more on that later. But today I'd like to focus on three areas that irk me as an owner trying to establish a small business, hire local people, satisfy the needs of our customers, and grow beyond our borders one day, as well as a Pennsylvania resident and consumer. First, it's difficult to earn sufficient profit to succeed as a wine distributor in Pennsylvania. I mean no disrespect, but I sort of had to chuckle this morning when I heard a number of times that prices are totally determined by the supplier. So I'd like to tell you, you know, how we're influenced by doing business in Pennsylvania. In a free market, we should be looking at our needs and the market to establish prices that cover our costs and provide a suitable profit while being competitive and providing value to our customers. Consumers here know wine and spirits cost less outside the state. Border bleed is huge as tens of thousands drive to Delaware, Maryland, Ohio, New York, and New Jersey every day to buy liquor and wine, costing the state billions in lost sales and tax revenues, and companies like mine lose a tremendous amount too. So when setting prices, we're often concerned about how they compare to neighboring states. So we apply lower margins due to the burden that the LCB adds. I spoke with the buyer of a prominent Philadelphia steakhouse last week that said, "You should follow me around on a weekend to see how often I have to apologize for the wine prices." He cited an example many customers are aware of. A bottle of Camus Cabernet sells for $65 in New Jersey and $84 in Pennsylvania, increasing the restaurant's price $60 or more when adding his typical markup. We make $2 or 24% margin on one of our top sellers, while the state makes $4.69 or 57% selling to licensees, and $6.12 or 74% profit on retail. And for what? For providing complex, inefficient, time-consuming systems and processes, distribution through cumbersome state stores that lack knowledgeable personnel to sell quality wines, and poor storage conditions, to name a few. What I'd like to do is kind of go off script for a minute, because I had some ideas while listening to David speak from the Distilled Spirits Council. So I'd like to tell you a little bit about what we do for $2 a bottle as a wholesaler. So here's kind of what a day in the life of an SLO order is at the Artisan Cellar. And my notes are just kind of scribbled as I listen this morning, so please bear with me. First, our sales employees promote our wines to restaurants, going around telling them about the wines, tasting. Customers call our reps or text or email with their orders throughout the week. During the evenings, we run internal reports, and one of us enters these orders into the LCB portal. We have to go onto the portal and put in the LID number, the store, the SLO code, and the quantity. Let me say that working on the LCB portal is painfully slow. You put in information and you just watch the little wheel spin, and a few seconds or several seconds later, oftentimes, you can continue. So it's very, very difficult. So then the next day, we come in the morning, We print three copies of those orders from the portal. We print two box labels to put on the ends of each case. And what we do at Artisans is we inventory everything we sell. We currently have about 350 labels, 15 different keg labels. In order to source or in order to inventory everything, we must source, purchase, pay for, and store all of the products that we sell, oftentimes well in advance of actually selling them. So then we pull the bottles. Our orders range from 2 to 3 bottles to maybe 2 or 3 cases. We box them, we apply the labels, and we deliver them to the store in our own van. Then we return, process the paperwork internally, and we're paid 60 days later. All for $2, $4, $5 a bottle for the most part. So our importers also make less selling in Pennsylvania because they often charge us less because they know the burden that is placed upon us by the LCB. So you've got a couple of people in the chain that are affected by this. As mentioned, multiple taxes add cost. The Johnstown flood tax is already in the SLO markup. Then there's the sales tax charged at the store, and then again the restaurant when the restaurant sells the wine. The LCB's payment terms are also unfair. The state is paid immediately when products are picked up, yet distributors must wait 60 days for payment. The LCB used to pay us in 30 days, and we just started doing business and selling wine in Delaware as well about a month ago, and we're paid the week after the customer pays for the wine. So my second point is to discuss some of the logistical and operational challenges dealing with state stores. We deliver to stores in Philadelphia and adjacent counties ourselves, and we UPS elsewhere in the state. A city the size of Philadelphia needs more than one wholesale or warehouse store. The only one in Philadelphia is store 5103 on 22nd and Washington Avenue, where we deliver at least twice a week. Others in Region 1 are Broomall, which is either 12 or 20 miles away from Philadelphia, depending on which route you drive, and Feasterville, which is 24 miles out. 5103 has several loading docks, warehouse workers, and ample parking, all necessary to move the volume of products required for the Philadelphia market. By contrast, retail stores in Philadelphia are difficult to deliver to. They're on busy streets with little parking. We often park a block or two away, carry or hand-trucked cases and kegs now, a block or more. We've dropped cases, we've broken bottles, and we received plenty of parking tickets as well. Our driver circled for 1.5 hours last week to deliver to, or before he could park at 5144 at 12th and Chestnut. We only have one driver with 10 or more stops a day, so delays in deliveries really hurt us. Also, some retail employees have difficulty handling cases, and especially kegs now, which weigh 70 pounds. These are a little bit easier to handle at a warehouse location where you've got warehouse workers that can handle the products much easier. I'd like to see one or two more wholesale or warehouse locations in Philadelphia to improve the quality and efficiency of the delivery and distribution process. Also, storage conditions at state stores can ruin wine. We've invested substantially to store all of our wine at 55 degrees, only to deliver it to a store where it may sit a few days at 80 degrees or more before it's being picked up. The wine loses its flavor, and we must replace it at no cost. Or no charge, rather. I'm sorry. It's plenty of cost. Finally, I want to reemphasize the losses caused by the code approval or product introduction process that Jason has described. What was once a 2 or 3 day process just a couple of years ago to enter new products is now 2 weeks. And again, that's in the slow season, but lengthens dramatically at year end. As Jason said, codes applied for last August weren't approved until February of this year. So tens of thousands of cases sit at distributor warehouses that can't be sold. Champagne and sparkling wines were bought for the holidays and codes were applied for well in advance, only to wait until February for approval. These needed to be sold for New Year's, not Easter. So At that point, prices are slashed and to move the product, and we all lose money, with the LCB in Pennsylvania losing the most. The solution is easy. Simply hire more clerical people, as this is costing the state and everyone in the distribution channel millions. We started selling in Delaware last month, as I mentioned, and all it takes for us to enter new products is to type brand descriptions and prices onto our own product pages in the Delaware Beverage Guide. It's very quick and easy. So these are the challenging areas that I wanted to share today. Solve the problems with markups, taxes, facilities, and processes, and we'll all sell more and generate higher revenue and profits. Border bleed will diminish, and consumers will buy more wine and spirits at Pennsylvania stores and restaurants. Thank you for listening and considering improvements for selling and distributing wine and spirits in the Commonwealth.
Thank you very much, and this was, to me, a very impressive panel. Representative Payne has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, Representative Sonney had a question. I had to leave, so I'm asking one for him. One of you two stipulated that you bought wine, I think, at this price, but went into the store and found it substantially, I believe, less, yet you're supposed to be getting the discount price. Could you elaborate on that? And is that accurate? I mean, if that's true, then are you now driving to the store and buying the 20 bottles or 30 bottles instead of getting the discount?
Yeah, that'll happen a good amount. So I guess there are two different codes. If you go into the PLCB search catalog, you'll see something listed as retail or luxury, I think the term is in the PLCB, and SLO or wholesale. So when Jason and Scott distribute their books, everything that they've coded is SLO, and it's presented in a wholesale pricing arrangement. Again, we don't get that wholesale price, but that's how it's presented. The PLCB goes through the process of making larger buys throughout the year, sometimes directly from wineries, sometimes from larger wholesalers, Southern Wine and Spirits, Capital. Some companies have brought in some great wines into Pennsylvania, but also have a much larger footprint in terms of distribution in PA versus, you know, smaller guys like Jason and Scott. And so the PLCB can go to those companies and say, we'll take 1,000 cases. They can go to a winery and say, we'll take everything from this vintage that you can give us. And the winery might be in a position to say, it wasn't the best vintage for us. Let us give it to you at a discounted rate because you're buying so much of it. And to be fair to the PLCB, it does seem like they turn those savings back to the retail consumer a better part of the time, but it doesn't negate the fact that it's still in a price book somewhere in one of those wholesalers' catalogs for, again, $8.99 if it's that Rex Goliath Zinfandel, but the state was able to buy so much of it and sell it for $6.49 to a retail consumer. And so, again, if you think about it, I could spend $1 million a year in purchases with the PLCB and have less purchasing power than somebody spends $100 a year and can walk in off the street and buy that same wine for cheaper.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I had two now that I'm done with supporting my colleague. On the wholesale side, and I'm relating to my days in a private candy location or even cars. I know if you're the largest dealer, you get a discount. And it's different than another location that doesn't quite sell as many. So what I'm looking at is, are you able to get the discount, or do you co-op an area to buy to get a better discount, or how's that work for you're all on your own and you all get the same discount? I mean, if I'm selling 1 million bottles of wine, I should be getting a better deal than the person selling 10 bottles of wine. Help me out.
Jason, maybe you could talk about just pricing structure in New Jersey where, you know, we can buy 10 cases, 15 cases, 25 cases, and get a much better deal on it. Again, we can't do that here.
Yes, that's correct. So when I mentioned in my speech, there's one price. So we set the price, and then no matter if you're buying one bottle or 100 cases, the restaurants are paying the same exact price for that wine no matter what. So yes, there's no way for any restaurant to get any sort of advantage by buying more. There's no incentive whatsoever. And I think the other interesting point too that Steve made about the listed in the shelf versus SLO wines is technically that's not even allowed to happen. So when a wine is registered in the state, it's supposed to be at one price and through one channel. Either it's listed, or it's luxury, or it's SLO. The fact that there even exists an SLO code for a wine that is also listed is just demonstrating the inefficiencies of the PLCB to sufficiently track these products. And that's why there are these discrepancies in pricing going on. So they can't.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks. I have one last question. And that deals with you cited the example of the champagne, that you ordered it, but it showed up in February. Now, somebody could argue, well, anybody can find one example. I mean, that was the first time in 10 years that that's happened. Or is this a consistent, ongoing problem that the stuff that you're ordering is not being, you're constantly having problems, you're constantly not getting your full order? I love that example. It's like going to the fast food and ordering at the window. I don't do it anymore. I go inside so I know I got what I want.
I think that we deal with the warehouse as much as we possibly can, and we do a lot of SLO. I think that the warehouses, or at least the Lancaster warehouse, is much, much more efficient. And if we go to across town to pick up something that's a specialty item, and there they don't even, when they see a licensee come in, they turn around, they walk away. They don't even want to deal with you. So I think there's more mistakes made at that type of location than there is at a warehouse. Going back to the 10% discount, that's it. You get a dime on a dollar, and then they slap you with 6% sales tax. So, you know, you ended up with 4 cents. You know, it's pretty embarrassing. And I'm going to finish up, too, about what he said about the pricing. This happens to us frequently, to our restaurant frequently. So much so that my daughter looks for that. Even on items that are listed that we're purchasing, maybe we're having a nice wine dinner. We do one every 45 days. She'll return items because there might be a 20, 25% difference in pricing. You know, that's a quarter. You know, we're getting 10 cents here and we're getting a quarter here. So every nickel and dime in our industry means something to us. So there is that factor out there, and it's so prevalent that she actually watches for this all the time.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Delozier.
Thanks, and I believe a little bit of my question was just asked, but I'm just trying to clarify the Easter, Christmas, New Year's thing. So you place an order, and this is already an approved item to be sold, or this is a brand new item? Okay, so you're in October deciding that you're going to sell a new product for New Year's, Christmas, that type of thing. You put something in to get approved by the LCB to sell that at their store, to be able to sell that in your restaurant?
Right.
Okay, so typically you're saying it should take, you're talking about in other states, you know, a week turnaround, that type of thing. Here, obviously you're not getting it till Easter. So at that point, you're also making your measurement as to how much you want. Is that correct? You're saying how much of it you want to sell?
Well, we would have already placed our order for the product. Usually we code the product or we request approval. Maybe we've already made the decision that the product is, we want the product.
Okay.
It's coming in. We determine how much we want. It may be on its way. So we'll go ahead and request the code approval.
Oh,
now,
okay.
Typically, though, again, it used to take 2-3 days, and then all of a sudden, maybe when the SLO group would get busier, it may take a couple of weeks. I don't know what happened last year. In our 5 years in business, it was unbelievable that codes that we applied for in August were not approved until.
And without that code, you can't.
And that's when, as Jason mentioned, that all of a sudden they said, geez, we're so backed up, there will be no more new product introductions until we get this straightened out. So I don't know what happened last year, but it was kind of a one of a kind. We certainly brought it up because hopefully that won't happen again this year.
And that's on you when you have that product and you've ordered a certain amount, but you cannot sell it.
Right.
You're stuck with it.
Right.
Correct. Yeah. So then you, okay,
yeah,
and there's no return.
We can't sell it because we can't enter an order for it into the portal.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for that clarification.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else? Well, I don't have any questions because you were so clear. on exactly what you're experiencing and the problems. And I think your testimony is very troubling because there are so many different issues that seem to be interfering with your business, interfering with your ability to do a good job for your customers. And as you point out, to the degree that this interferes with tax collection here in Pennsylvania, product being sold that would have otherwise been sold, discouraging people so that they go to other states. The restaurant and hospitality industry is really important to us in Pennsylvania. And you represent a lot of small businesses. You employ a lot of people. And I feel pretty strongly that we ought to not be an impediment to you, but we ought to try and cooperate with you as you're trying to do a good job for the public at large, and also to make a decent living for the people that you employ. Mm-hmm. So I'm very glad you came today. I'm very glad that you put this information in front of us. And I'm going to make an effort to make sure that the members that were unable to attend today also have access to your testimony so that they hear what you said today, too. And I know it is not easy sometimes to testify when you're also with some criticisms for an agency that also licenses you. So I appreciate your candor and courage. I know you found things that you like about the LCB, and you appreciate individuals who have tried to help you. But you've also been, I think, quite clear on the places where we have some real areas to improve. Before I close, I did want to also mention that we had had written testimony from the Pennsylvania Wine and Spirits Association, which was included in the members' packets and provided to others, which is, of course, available for others that wish to hear what they had to say. Anything else?
I would just like to add to thank all the testifiers for being here today, and it was very educational and informative for us, and particularly the last panel, and hopefully that the LCB is listening to what your issues are, and hopefully that somewhere we can fix some of those issues for you.
And with that, I'm going to adjourn the informational meeting with thanks for everybody who attended.